want you for a year or two.
6 months, guaranteed.
All right, hello and welcome everybody to the April 11th meeting of the Finance Committee here in South Deerfield, Massachusetts at the town office. We have six of us here tonight. I think that's what we're going to have. And Doug is in the back printing out a couple of things, and then we'll get started with him while we wait. Just to give everyone an idea of what we'll be doing tonight, we're going to be going over some remaining omnibus budget items and then going over a number of warrant items, both from the special town meeting as well as the annual town meeting, both of those being held concurrently a couple weeks from now. So I guess we'll start with the meeting minutes as we often do. I passed out copies. It's front and back, so there's four pages, quite a few things we covered, a number of things we voted, and some other things that we discussed. And as always, please let me know if anybody sees a missing number or something that doesn't look right or something that isn't there that they want to see. And thanks again to Mary for all this note-taking. These are fairly extensive, and I cleaned them up a little bit, but she puts a lot of stuff in here, so.
Make a motion to accept them as printed.
Do I have a second?
Second.
Right, thanks. Any other discussion or comments? All right, all those in favor?
Aye. Aye.
All right, thanks. Here, Doug, I'll give you a copy just so you have them. I'll send them electronically. We just accepted. And okay, so let's see. Let's get situated. All right, so what we're going to start with is we have a handful of individual budgets that we've discussed before, have not voted. A couple of them include Doug, so I will start with one that does not as directly include him, although they do all include him in some form or fashion. Police payroll. So this is budget number 210-5110. And we had discussed this before, and I think the only outstanding item or concept on this budget that was not filled in when we first talked about it a couple months ago was related to the school resource officer. A line item for that position has since been put in, and there are a couple of other adjustments up to line items for Quinn bill and overtime pay, which are calculated just as a percent of full-time salary. So as the full-time salary line item went up, they went up in lockstep with it. To generate the number on the requested budget I see of $751,466. And I guess I'll start by just passing along. There's a couple things that I wanted to verify, and so I went and tried to do that. As I've said before, the concern I have with this position is if it actually is a school resource officer position in conjunction with the schools in the manner that this position is intended and a number of people are in favor of. The one thing I checked was the Mass General Laws state that the superintendent and chief of police shall enter into a written memorandum of understanding to clearly define the role and duties of the school resource officer, which shall be placed on file in the office of the school superintendent. And this has not been done. And I guess this is just a sign of a number of things I see in this. It does not seem we're kind of ready to do this. I think the hindsight on this, and this is it seems like we thought we had a funding source set up for this, and then it kind of fell through related to the dispensary monies we thought may come in. And when that wasn't there, then we kind of turned to look to the schools fairly late in their budget session. And their response at that point in time was at the place they were in the budget at that point in their budget year, it was not something they could support. I confirmed with Marty today that was still their position, that they do not oppose the concept of it, but the way that this has been brought to them and the request made of them at that point in time, they did not support that. So that's kind of the information I was able to either dig out or confirm, and I'd put that to you guys and see what you all think at this point.
I think it's appropriate for them to say if we're that far along in our budget, we just made room for it. The flip side of that is they probably should have known to work it out ahead of time.
Well, you just expressed several concerns that I had also of
that they, it doesn't appear that they've come to an agreement for the role of the officer. Again, I think everybody kind of agrees with the concept. It's just, what role is that going to play, and also the funding for it? And at the 11th hour, as you said, the funding kind of fell through, so that leaves us with, you know, the $30,000 from the private schools to try to help fund that. And does that mean that we need to leave as is for another year and have them do like they did last year on kind of a part-time basis and backfilling with the, if they want to try to maintain that position and bring this forward again next year?
Right.
And I don't know, to be honest with you, I don't know any other way of doing it to try to mandate a vote on it when the two parties have not even reached consensus as far as what that role is going to be. I just find it kind of difficult to vote that, to recommend that.
And I agree. I think it is a little more challenging for all parties to have, you know, you have a regional high school, a number of non-regional grammar schools, and multiple private schools. So there's a lot of moving parts, and I think that the structure of that does need to be, you know, formulated in a way that everybody's kind of on board with. And I guess the one other thing I'd throw in, because this has come up with, you know, this is somewhat of a mandate. The state did recommend that towns mm-hmm. have a school resource officer. They do not need to. They did not fund it. And so there is, there's a manner in which the schools can get a waiver from this quote unquote retirement. And, you know, just to, again, to kind of lay the ground where we are, the schools were in preparation and in the process of submitting to get that waiver about a year ago, when then they were told that this position was going to be funded from other means, and so we didn't need the waiver. We're going to be able to do it without them having to fund it. So, you know, again, I think that the school's position on this has been fairly consistent and not really in lockstep with the request in this budget here.
My only comment is I'm going to abstain from any discussion and any vote.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
I'm going to abstain from all of it.
So noted. Thank you. Doug, what are your thoughts? If you have any, I know we've talked about this before, so it may be.
The difference between having the school resource officer funded and not having the school resource officer funded is, including benefits, about $26,000, because there's $30,000 coming in from Deerfield Academy, who's been extremely generous and is very supportive of the position. The chief emphasized to me that he has been meeting with the superintendent, the principal, and the assistant principal at the regional school. The chief mentioned that he had delivered to the superintendent of schools, I believe he said 59 pages worth of incidents that police officers had been involved with at Frontier Regional School in this year alone, since July 1, my understanding, or at least in the past 12 months. Everything from simply a stop in and a check to things that were more serious and required more attention. So the police are currently involved there. The police are currently helping and assisting as they can. I believe that it's the police chief and his intention to continue doing this as best as he can, but I believe he's also very interested in having this be a formal arrangement for a number of reasons. It will further push the schools to adopt this formally, to make this arrangement, which will enable the chief, or I'm sorry, the school resource officer, to do more for the students at the school. And the more that there is a person there who has a law enforcement background, who's had the training, who's had the school resource officer training, as our school resource officer has, then the greater potential there is to detect, to observe, and to seek out or find problems before they become bigger problems, before they become disastrous problems. I understand and appreciate the concerns that folks have about the cost. I understand and appreciate the concerns that folks have about the sort of disparity between what the schools are able to afford this fiscal year versus what was asked for. I believe that that will change in FY18. And I believe that we will see a great deal more cooperation on the part of the schools as they develop their budgets for next year, as well as the police as they continue to develop and grow this position. And so I would encourage the Finance Committee to recommend this.
Okay.
And I came from the other side, just so you know. I came from the other side thinking, this seems like something, this seems ridiculous. The schools don't want this. Why are we pushing for this? I'm now pretty convinced that it's an essential thing to have.
Okay.
This, the $40,000, does that include any Quinn bill that this officer gets paid?
The total for that we've set aside in the budget, the total set aside in the budget for the, wow, where's that number coming from?
55.1.
Oh, that's where that number came from. The total being set aside in the budget for this officer is, for the new officer, is about 41 rough for salaries. It's, I think, 1,200 for the educational stipend, and then benefits. 55, 56 round numbers.
We got no numbers.
Minus 30. It's 26. Okay. Yeah. So.
This school resource officer, how many hours are we talking about here?
It's a full-time position. Yep. And it is... a different position in that, and here's where I'm treading on very thin ice because I just don't admit to knowing it entirely. My understanding is that the police currently have, I think it's a 3-on-2-off schedule. They work 3 days, they have 2 days off. They work 3 days, they have 2 days off, so on and so forth. And in this case, an arrangement has been worked out with this officer and with the police union so that the school resource officer can work 5 days in a row, Monday through Friday, during school time. So it's different from what all the other officers are working, and that enables that person to focus more closely on what's going on with the school.
It's staged differently.
Exactly. It's staged differently. So it is a unique position.
But this is a whole new position. It's a whole new position.
What the police chief is doing with this budget is basically formalizing the fact that he needs another officer full time.
Right.
He's not bringing on a school resource officer, he's bringing on a new entry-level cop. And that entry-level cop is going to go 3-on-2-off, work the regular shift, as all the other officers do, so that the person assigned as the school resource officer can continue his Monday through Friday daytime shift as school resource officer. I hope that makes sense. We're not paying for the SRO, we're paying for the cop that, otherwise, up to this point, John has been paying for with per diems.
Right, like the person listed as SRO on the budget is not the SRO.
Mm-hmm. Right. Another question I have then, if we're doing the regional school and Deerfield is voting this as far as picking up salary, then is there, seeing how it's a regional school, is there any fee to Sunderland or Whately?
It would come through the school budget.
It would come through the school budget, but this funding this first year, won't be coming through the school budget.
That's correct.
So the town of Deerfield will essentially be picking up the whole thing.
Right. So we're subsidizing about 50% of the cost that otherwise would be portioned out. Assuming they wouldn't pick up all of it, so we don't know exactly how it'd be broken out, but 50% of whatever Frontier's breakout would be, we're now paying for.
Right.
This is why the chief is very committed to working with the school leadership and the new superintendent to make sure that this is on their budget for next year.
But this one also takes care of the elementary, which is...
The expectation is, yes, the person is still available at the elementary school. The understanding is that...
I know it's not very much. We talked about it, but I just making that point because there's Conway and Sunderland and Whately and Deerfield at the Frontier.
Well, the officer wouldn't be serving the other three town elementary schools.
I didn't.
My understanding.
I was not implying that. No.
Okay.
No. Yeah, that's not.
No, no. You had only said Sunderland and Whately, and I tried to inject Conway.
Oh, yeah. As far as the regional school.
So
yes.
I can kind of came back to it to get the full picture.
Do Sunderland, Whately, and Conway have a resource officer?
The four towns.
At the elementary schools.
Most of the officers work is.
Right.
At the regional.
I think Conway
but
has
I just kind of footnoting.
Right. I just want to make sure that we're clear on the elementary level.
Yeah.
Okay.
Well, I guess it's strange for me to come to the defense, but since the private school put that much up for it, they obviously see a value in it. If we voted this year and sent a letter both to the superintendent's office and to the chief saying here's where we're going to stand in the future, if you don't get together and budget this through the school, then we can't.
I guess I just feel somewhat uncomfortable somewhat forcing a position not only onto but into the schools that the schools themselves are going to seek a waiver from.
Right.
To me, like, obviously there's a budget component and I get that, and this isn't, you know, we're talking about numbers that are manageable but are also not insignificant.
Mm-hmm.
But it's not just about numbers for me. I you know, I guess I'm not sure why those conversations weren't had 6 to 9 months ago. And I know that's kind of after the fact, and we'll try to have them and going forward this year. So that's where is it not possible to keep, we're already doing what we're planning to do. We're already doing it
mm-hmm.
without having a larger budget.
Yeah.
So, you know, and what is the feasibility of being able to continue to do this and then have that conversation so that the FY18 budget has an MOU between the schools and the police and has all the details that you want, so then you come forward with your plan and the cost and how it's going to be apportioned and vote it. And I understand that you can't always do things the cleanest way. Sometimes you have to react and respond to the situation presented to you. To me, given that we're already doing what we're saying we're going to do, and it's already being budgeted in the police payroll budget somehow, and the schools were going to seek a waiver from the SRO because we're a low-incident region, another low-incident, or district, rather, that's where I kind of have a tough time, given the other things that we've not recommended. I mean, we have not recommended additional staff or hours and the number of budgets, and I think we'll be doing more before we're done. And this is again another example of putting something into a budget 1 year and then asking for the funding to do it the next year without any reduction in how you paid for it the first time.
Mm-hmm.
And again, I've been pretty consistently opposing those types of budget mechanics because I don't think it's healthy in the long term, even if the particular item that we're talking about is something that I could support in other cases.
The position I've always supported, and I think it's probably in this day and age badly needed, so there's no question about that. But I've listened to all of you with your concerns, and I hear that clearly too. And as I said one time, I think it was no one really paid much attention, but I just said that, you know, if this only really works, the officer only really works if there's total buy-in between the school and the police. I think there's no question on the police side. And of course, somebody I think did comment quickly saying, well, you know, Marty supports it, but that isn't what I meant by total school buy-in. I mean the trustees, the school board,
right,
and
the
all of the staff.
Right.
If they truly, emotionally feel that this is really important, like I think,
mm-hmm.
then this would be a real priority in their minds to make sure the paperwork and the rules and regs were followed, and I'm always have been a stickler about rules and regs. And if it's true what you say, Dylan, that even this thing isn't on file, you know, it's messy. And so in a way, we're being asked to vote for something because it's really needed and it's really good and it's really important, and I think we all agree. But on the other hand, we're voting on behalf of the citizens, the residents of the town, spending their money on something that's a little loosey-goosey, and you know, so I think I'm
well. There's not full agreement. That's a problem.
There's not full
agreement between all parties at the moment, and that puts us in a very difficult position. And I agree with Dylan. Myself, personal experience, I've dealt with this issue, and I see a lot of value to it. But at the same time, I'm struggling to vote that without a full agreement between all parties.
Pieces aren't all there. And
right.
And the other thing is, I mean, if this were a setup where our vote was killing the possibility of having this, it's hard to do that. It's hard to take that responsibility when we don't. You know, I've never run a school. I've never been a policeman, and so I understand. We're talking about very important things here, and I think this is a very good thing to be bringing to town meeting and to be able to present both sides, mm-hmm. and some of the different participants in this conversation come forward and kind of talk about where they're coming from. And so that's where, not to absolve ourselves because we still have a very important job, but I do feel confident in recommending less than the full budget as part of the process to have this conversation on town hall floor and say, look, we're not here to talk about the validity of having a school resource. We're talking about where the box is checked, did this pass the budget process test? And I think a number of us have concerns that it hasn't.
Yeah.
And if the town then decides, and maybe someone wants to come talk to us about it now,
right.
that's a conversation.
Apparently somebody's watching TV.
I think we're more than happy to have.
Yep, I agree.
And I think we're going to talk about it some more.
Hi. No.
Oh, okay.
No, I haven't heard anything.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Hi, John.
Other than residents texting me and saying, get to the meeting.
Okay. Well, I'll try to provide a brief recap of the conversation, and Doug, feel free to jump in. Basically, what we're trying to weigh here is the fact that we're trying to opine from a finance committee standpoint on a budget item, with the reality that none of us have been, many of us have not been either police officers or teachers to really be able to say what's been done, what's being done, what's going to be done. And the struggle that, and I'll speak for myself here and anyone else can chime in, the struggle that I've had is when I look at the way that this position has been articulated to be brought forth, first of all, I was just looking through Mass General Laws to have a school resource officer, supposed to have a memorandum of understanding between the school and the police to clearly define the duties and role of the position. To my knowledge, that hasn't been done. I understand that we thought we had funding set up for this, and maybe that's why the funding conversation was not had with the schools initially. And then when that funding conversation was brought to the schools, their position at that time, and still, to my knowledge, is that they are not prioritizing that for this year in their budget based, I guess, primarily on when it was brought to them. I can't speak for them on what other issues they may or may not have with it, but that it's not in their budgets currently. And so that's where I think some of us have concerns about recommending the full budget with the position, given that these things have not been done, understanding that we may be back here next year with the agreements in place, with the budget ready to go and move forward then. Or even if we recommend a lower amount at town meeting floor, you and others may stand up and articulate the importance of not waiting another year and do it now. And the town may decide to do that now. So I understand it's very hard to have this conversation without getting wrapped up into the position and the reality of what this means for the town. But at least at this point, I have concerns about supporting the full budget because of the way the budget has been brought. And I'm really trying to realize, like, we have a very narrow focus here. Finance committee is simply that, the finance committee. And when we look at the budgets that come before us, we have pushed back on increases in other budgets that similarly, from a budget standpoint, didn't hold up as much as other things that we are having to prioritize. And this is just from a budget standpoint, not from a department standpoint or from a needs standpoint. The other thing we've done consistently is we have been holding back on increasing services or hours, which obviously this is one. And we've also been holding back on items that the services provided in FY16 and then added to the budget in FY17. And that, again, is something that we have here. So that's kind of the conversation we had. Doug spoke as well and articulated an importance. A number of us, I don't think anybody feels slam dunk one way about this. I think it's a tough thing for everyone.
Mm-hmm.
And so thank you for joining us. And very
well, it's a shocker for me because I was out to dinner with my family. And the last time I met with you guys, the only time I met with you guys, the last comment that you guys had was, how do we articulate to the Board of Selectmen that this is a priority to us? So I don't understand where we've gone from there all the way back. That's my concern.
Okay.
The MOU, Marty Barrett has asked me for samples. Deerfield Academy, towards a $50,000 position, have given us $30,000, so it's an absolute priority to them. We're looking for $20,000. That's realistically what we're looking for 2,400 kids in town. Yep. So to me, it is very passionate. Mm-hmm. The law mandates it, subject to funding. I understand that's in there, subject to funding. But the law does mandate it.
It does
we
not.
Examined.
Excuse me, it does not mandate it. You can get an exemption. Marty was prepared and in the process of getting an exemption a year ago when then she was told that the position was both appropriated and funded. So she stopped with the exemption. And maybe that's not right. That's what she told me today.
That's the first I've ever heard of it. So my concern is in looking at the position, this is not just about school safety. Do I think there's going to be an active shooter event in Deerfield? No, I don't. But how do I sit back as your chief public safety official with 2,400 kids in this town and say your elementary and high school budgets alone combined is $18 million, but we shouldn't put a cop in there to have a continuous flow of information and resources back and forth when we inherit those kids 18 hours a day? The school has them 6 hours a day. We have them 18. We respond to their houses after hours. It's a continuity of information flowing back and forth, and it's a true partnership and team. And I thought Marty Barrett was on board with this. She articulated she was at the last school safety meeting 2 weeks ago, so I don't understand. Marty one day tells me yes, the next day she tells me no. So I don't understand. All I want is a firm position of where people stand in the best interest of the kids. That's all I care about.
Right.
Am I looking to overbuild the police department? Absolutely not. But if we save one kid from a violent home, if we save one kid from heroin or anything else, have we done our part? Those are immeasurable. Mm-hmm. I'm looking for $20,000. I'm not looking for the 50. The 30's already coming from Deerfield Academy. $20,000 for 2,400 kids. To me, it's a no-brainer. But I appreciate you guys because you guys see the full budget. I don't. Mm-hmm. I see the police department. I can tell you all day long, and I'll stand in front of 600 people at town meeting. $20,000 for 2,400 kids, hands down, best investment.
Yeah.
That's it.
One of the questions, John, was that it's going to be mostly at Frontier. And Deerfield will be paying the total cost for Frontier. There's four schools in there.
Do I think that's fair? No, I don't. I would like to see the school committee step up. And I can tell you again, 2 weeks ago in a school safety meeting with police chiefs, fire chiefs, and the four principals, Marty Barrett says that this should be a priority for next budget season.
That's
so
a year away.
How do I sit back and say, oh, I'm going to take a backseat role when I have somebody there that already has a rapport and relationship with these students in that flow of information? How do I now take a step back and go, oh, we can't find the 20 grand, and if your kid suffers because of it, I'm not in a position to recommend that.
But you have an officer already doing that.
We do. The problem is we need the additional funding to permanently continue it. I've put it in place in a temporary part-time capacity. We're looking to expand it. So the other comment was made is, well, would Deerfield Academy give us anything more? And I said, you know what? Keith Finan's been incredible to this town. Mm-hmm. He probably would give us more. But here's the downside to that. If I take another $10,000 or $20,000 from Deerfield Academy, that position is no longer going to Frontier Regional. That position is dedicated to DA alone. Because I can't reasonably take $50,000 from them and pull a position out of that school. They're paying 40 hours a week. They get that 40-hour benefit. Right now, them giving $30,000 and us looking for $20,000 to cover four other schools, I think is very gracious of them. I think we're in a perfect position. $20,000 for 2,400 kids. That's what I'm looking for.
All right, I understand that, and that's obviously a very powerful argument, and that's why this is not easy for anybody to be on one side or the other here. Just back to an earlier comment about the last time you were in here, when you presented the budget, and there were very good reasons for this, there was no line item for school resource officer because at the time, nobody knew how it was going to be funded. And so we did and will be supportive of the concept of a school resource officer that's a collaborative effort between the school and the police force and funded in whatever agreement that those entities come up with. So I very much appreciate your position, but I don't think anything we talked about in that meeting is any different what we're talking about here. And if you can appreciate that there is uncertainty about the school's partnership on this. At this point in time, that is, you know, to me, I don't even have, it's almost, I don't even feel like I need to have a position. All right, if the two people that are collaborating on this support it, then I support it. And when they don't, then it's hard for me to support it. And I also don't want to come down too hard on the schools here because, you know, first of all, I don't like playing who said what when, because that's tough for everybody, especially when they're not here. And also, you know, we are trying to fix this going forward. We are trying to do something going forward. So if I could ask you, what is the ability to continue to provide the service we're currently providing with the budget that you have, given the fact that we've done it this year? Because to my knowledge, this year we've had the service, we've been backfilling with part-time, and we have not used any of the money that Deerfield Academy gave us for FY16.
Some of the money's been used. I don't know how much to date. I'd have to look back because I was not prepared for tonight.
Fair enough.
So I don't know. I can tell you that my budget is very, very close, where usually I have a lot of wiggle room, and I'm going to have to take more money out of that school resource officer budget to make year-end meet. How much I can continue it next year, I don't know.
Okay.
Again, I'm unprepared for this meeting.
Fair
enough. Somebody came back to me after your previous meeting and said, hey, John, hey, Chief, we have questions about this, I would have came back to you with statistics, data, analysis.
But, John, that's not where the questions are. We feel that all the portions of the community have moved forward to do this, and we don't think it's a good position. I defer to you and the schools as to whether this is a good position. And now we're being asked to opine on if we should recommend this budget with only one of those parties moving in that direction. That is very specifically why I didn't reach out to you today, because I don't feel it's a matter of me not understanding or us not understanding that there are valuable things that can happen as a result of having more police involvement interaction with kids in schools. I very much appreciate that. And so, you know, this is kind of the impasse we've come to of, it's challenging to think about this as a budget standpoint. And as right before you came in, we were saying, is this something that the town benefits from having the conversation on town meeting floor? Which obviously we could have either way, whether we recommend this budget or not. And again, I think that the town may agree for reasons bigger than a budgetary process to move forward with it. I'd sleep well at night if that happens. I'm not going to be upset if that happens. But our little world that we're trying to do here, that's where we're coming out having a tough time with it. Especially to the extent that, you know, if there was part-time pay being reduced and you saying, all right, I'm going to have the full-time officer, so all the part-times or per diems or overtime or however I was backfilling the other one, that comes down some. That at least demonstrates some of the movement of the pieces in the budget working together. Still doesn't solve all the problems, but that's kind of what we've looked at so far.
But the budget technically is coming down. It's not a $55,000 request. It's a $20,000 or $25,000 request because of the $30,000 from Deerfield Academy.
Right.
Now, how Doug works that into the budget, that's on him.
And
that's way over my head.
It's already figured out. It's already included as a revenue source for next year.
Okay.
I would also like.
But you're going to include the
$30,000.
It's all right.
It's actually not a $25,000 difference between having that ninth officer position as you've got in here versus not taking into account the $30,000 from the private school donation. It's a difference of $12,000. That's the difference we're really looking at.
Okay.
Is $12,000 between not having that new entry-level police officer, which is what we're looking at doing.
Yes.
And allowing the school resource officer to continuing doing that job full-time as he has been. It's a difference of $11,000 or $12,000after you include the donation.
My only question is, John, you've already said that you've used some of that $30,000 already this year. And
yes.
The year has to go to July.
This is a different $30,000.
That would be next
year. They gave
year.
Us what, $30,000 last year?
$30,000 a year from
correct.
Deerfield Academy.
Okay. I didn't understand that.
I think it's very important, and we very much value that they not only support it in concept, but are supporting it. I think that certainly helps it be a possibility. Mm-hmm. And so let's not let that be lost as we, you know, try to talk about the particulars of getting it started now. I mean, I think that to the extent there were more time and you working with the schools for FY18 budget, that we'd be back having boxes checked and moving forward, if that's the town's will, towards having that resource officer. So we're really just talking about a trade-off between doing it more procedurally correct versus and doing it now. That to me is kind of the trade-off.
It depends on what procedure you're looking at. Some people would view the procedure as funding first and MOUs as second. Some people would view the MOUs as first. Some people would like to put Frontier on board first because they're a regional asset.
Right.
I understand every particular situation. Unfortunately, my cooperation from the education environment has been limited. I'm sure you're well aware of that. So again, as your chief public safety official, what do I do? Do I take the old school approach and close my eyes and go, okay, they don't want to play in the sandbox, so I'm going to take a step back and I'm going to be ignorant? No, I can't do that. I have to come forth and say, hey, listen, if we can save a kid, if we can get in there, we can interact with the parents, the counselors, whoever it may be. I don't care if it's a drug problem. I don't care if it's a violence problem. I don't care if it's a kid that has a problem with arson. Mm-hmm. It doesn't matter to me. It matters to me that I have 2,400 kids with five schools in town. That's what really, I guess, challenges me in this situation. What do I do?
Right. And I think it's very unfair, the position that the state put you and the schools and the towns in general by creating, by recommending, I guess you'd call it a recommendation to do this, and not funding it and saying, well, it's not a mandate because the local school and police officer can say we don't need it. And I understand that procedure is in place and that that procedure was being pursued, but that's still a very difficult position to put individuals in that have to sign that document. And I very much appreciate that.
You weren't here earlier, and I don't want to go back through the whole thing, but, and I think I can speak pretty much for the board, that everybody supports the position. They see the value of it. So that's not in question. I don't think there's anything on the police department's arena that's in question. I think, though, from my perspective, what was brought to light by some of these people here earlier, a month ago or a couple of weeks ago, is the fact that it seems as though the school has been slow to get this discussed or on their budget. It's just kind of hanging out there. And my personal feeling was that, you know, I think we all recognize it as an extremely important thing, but it works best when the school and the police department are arm in arm with it. And I know there's certain ones, like Marty is arm in arm with it, but it's like the school board or somebody back there just isn't putting an importance on it budget-wise. So we're just, what they brought up are some technical facts of whether things are really written down and in place and agreed to, because if it isn't emotionally fully agreed to, if people don't see it important enough to talk about it in the budget or plan it in the budget, then do they really support it? I think it's really needed. I think it, I watch all the time with the Franklin trade up there and what they do. It's marvelous. And I'm sure it's the same down here. But I mean, these are educators. This is the school board and all the educators. And if they don't have deep-rooted emotions about the importance of it to the point that they can't get it on the docket, then are they really buying in? And I think that's the thing that's hanging out there for me.
So there's two approaches with that, Ralph, and I absolutely appreciate that. First of all, I apologize, walking in half out of it, I'm just getting what people are texting me in the community saying, you really need to walk into the finance committee meeting. So I apologize for that.
Thank you, everyone, for watching. And
so, but number two, there's two things I can do with the school, the education environment, the school committees. Number one, I can walk in and I can educate them. But I'm not sure that's going to change their mind. What changes their mind is when you have a person in there that facilitates that relationship, and all of a sudden, after a year or two, year three, they go, oh my God, we have no idea how we lived without this individual.
Yeah.
So those are my two different avenues. I tried avenue one. I tried the education. I tried, you know, getting the reasoning and understanding and trying to sell the position. Now I'm at the crossroad where I'm taking the other road, and so far the position has been success. And that's what I'd like to see. Actually, in the next month, I'd like to sit down with the vice principal and the principal of Frontier and say, what's good? What's bad? What do you like about it? What can we change? And let's finalize the MOU. Marty requested the MOUs from me. She specifically requested, I believe, two ones that I emailed the chiefs and already got them over to her. So I'm not sure where Marty stands on this today, but like I said, I know what she said in front of four police chiefs and fire chiefs 2 weeks ago.
Okay. Could you, and I know this won't change kind of what the decision we're faced with now, but could you kind of give your perspective on, if you had to do the last 11 months over again, are there things that we could have done, not just you, but all of us could have done, to have had some of these conversations sooner? And do you think that that would have gotten us into a different position now?
Well, I think no matter what, communication with department heads has to be ongoing throughout the year, whether it's quarterly meetings or biannual meetings. Mm-hmm. And where I'm slightly disappointed, and you can throw a rock at me, it's perfectly fine. When I left here a month and a half ago and I met with you and my father was gone, so there was no conflict of interest in Florida, everybody seemed like they were on board. It didn't seem like there was any remaining questions. I told you at any point in time, if you had questions, come back and see me. Invite me back to your meeting. I will come back any time. That didn't happen. I understand you're busy.
I don't think the question is to you. It's to the school.
It's the school.
They've had a year.
Oh, really?
To discuss this among themselves.
That's why I say it's nothing.
You're right, Chief. I think everybody is on board as far as the position and see the value of it. And that's beyond question. I think the confusion was as far as the funding of it. And our impression through the select board in school and that was something was going to be worked out to support the remainder of that budget. And then all of a sudden at the 11th hour, the school couldn't fund it because they already had their budget in place. The funding that the select board was thinking about did not happen. And so now it leaves the finance committee in a very, very bad place. So it makes it very difficult. I've had personal experience with resource officers in a building, and they work great. The benefits, so I have no question about it. The only problem is, how do we do this that's clean, that we can fund it and make sure it'll work? One question I brought up a little bit earlier was, well, even if we pushed it through this year, where does that leave us next year? If next year all of a sudden the schools don't want to put it in their budgets, then here we are again.
Well, that's an enormous question.
We now just put the full amount on Deerfield, and we're also funding a regional school that three other towns are not picking up any costs whatsoever, but are benefiting from it.
That's a big
concern. I know it's a very small amount, but still.
Yeah, it's not the amount.
Right.
It's just the principle of it.
Trying to be as clean as possible with this.
Right. And to be clear, this isn't, I don't want, there certainly is an aspect of this that has to do with more of a technocrat assessment of the procedures. And I think we all have talked that through and understand the limitations. That is part of it. But I do have some concern with the position, to the extent that we are putting an officer in the school to some extent. Mm-hmm. And it's not so much that I want to be okay with that, but that's why the MOU is important to me, not because it's a box, but because it's telling me that whatever agreement, and I don't even care what agreement you guys put together, because if you and the school both like it, then I'm going to like it. But I do have some concern that doesn't just have to do with how many dollars per student or following the procedures correctly, because I think part of that procedure is what imparts back onto us the partnership that Ralph talked about. And really all we're looking for to say, because if it's, you're right. I mean, if you put it in terms of how many kids are in town and what we can do, I get that. And I think that there's a number of people that may be willing to speak up at town meetings to varying degrees of agreement or opposition to the concept in terms of how effective an officer can be. Do we already have a parking lot full of people to be there to have relationships with these kids at these schools? I think there's a whole host of things that are going to come up regardless of what's voted here at town meeting. I think that's a good conversation to have.
Question, do we have enough time to hold this for another week and ask Doug and the chief if they could go to the school committees and try to get some type of letter of commitment, so that we know that they support this position?
I honestly,
I don't know if we'd have time to do it.
To be honest,
I'm just asking.
Good. Your Deerfield Elementary School Committee meeting at their public hearing, and at the Frontier Regional School Committee hearing, at their public hearing, when addressing the budget, my recollection, anybody can correct me if I'm wrong, but my recollection is that both school committees recognized the lateness of the request. They both recognized, and they said, if this had come to us sooner, we might have been able to find room in the budget, but at this point, the budget is solidified. But at both school committees, both meetings, members of both school committees recognized and appreciated the fact that there was this resource available to the students in the school. They all recognized the value of the position, and their only regret was that the funding request came in too late in order for them to actually make room in their budget, to solidify, to make the space, to make it work. Could they have found an extra $5,000 at Deerfield Elementary and $8,000 at Frontier Regional? We can speculate all week.
But wouldn't they be the ones that were making the request?
No, they should have
The school committee, yeah. I would think so. Yeah. That they establish policy, yeah, so that they say this is a priority.
That's my point, is
right.
If they truly saw it as a very important thing, just like having a teacher, you wouldn't forget it. So why wasn't it in the budget, is my point.
My question also is, you had an officer up there who's doing a fabulous job, and there's no question about that at all. But he's been there for a year, maybe more, and the schools know he's been there for a year, but Deerfield's picking up the tab for the whole thing, for the four towns.
The issue was, after town meeting last year, and I described this at the last finance committee meeting, when we set up that revolving school resource officer account, the residents actually thought we funded it. People came up to me after town meeting and said, congratulations, you got your school resource officer. And they say, time out. No, we didn't get it. All we did was establish an account. That's it. So Marty was under the opinion that, or the position, that it had already been fully funded. And she said, great, we got this resource. We enjoy Brian. He's doing a fabulous job. And literally it went right through till February, at which point you and I reached out. We had some communication back and forth. It was positive. Mm-hmm. Come to the school committee meeting. The budget wasn't solidified, but we are pretty much finalized. We went to the school committee meetings, and they're like, listen, we're at hour 23 3/4. We can't take this on at this point. So, but they were very positive.
They were extremely positive about the position. They're very supportive of the position. They recognize the asset that it was to the schools. Maybe this points to a bigger mechanical problem with the process of building the budget for the school, that they hold their public information session on the night that they vote on the final budget.
Yeah, it's kind of a...
Which is sort of like saying, well, we're about to slam the door in your face. Do you have any last... Bam! Yep.
To be fair, we had 9 months from last year's town meeting when the account was created but not funded, and that February to talk to them about this. Whether it was you or us or whoever, it's not about going to bat for or going against other people, but there was plenty of time to do this. And it wasn't done.
And you can bet that starting on July 1st,
right,
between the chief and myself, there will be somebody calling the high school every other week saying, how's your budget process doing? Do you have money in there for the school resource officer?
Really?
You're absolutely that? Right.
But to the other side of that, we don't know what we're going to get. Marty Barrett may retire and be incredibly healthy for the next 35 years. I wish her the best. She's been amazing. But we don't know what the new superintendent's going to be like. I can tell you superintendents have walked into school districts and said, this position is so important to me that I'm going to take the money out of school choice, and it's not even a school committee issue. It's done.
Right.
Put the position in place. This is a priority to me. Another superintendent can walk into place and say, we're a no-crime area. We've had minimal problems with drugs, and they minimize. We've all seen it. So we don't know what we're going to get. I don't know who's taking over beyond Marty. I hear incredible things about her, but I don't know her stance and position. Mm-hmm. So really, the next few months is going to be, uneven for us. Mm-hmm. And that's why I'd really like the position to continue, for them to see the value in it, for that rapport to continue right across through the kids.
That's what makes it challenging for us to go down the path when... I don't know what the percentage chances of one or the other, but if you get someone who doesn't want it, now where are we?
I hear you.
We were nervous about this before you walked in, because we feel like we're caught between a rock and a hard place a little bit, but it's not fair, on the other hand, not to be fair to the residents with the details, mm-hmm. and we don't seem to have all the details.
So let's remove Deerfield Elementary and Frontier from this. Two-thirds mm-hmm. of this pay has come from Deerfield Academy. The other two private schools are looking at kicking in towards this position. They've absolutely told me they support the position. It's whether finances allow. Eagle Brook's doing a lot of building, but Mint is not a high financial school. We know that. They're an incredible educational institution, but they don't have a huge endowment. Mm-hmm. So Ken Cutterback's been amazing. He absolutely values the position. He's like, John, if I can get you money, I will. but don't expect a lot from us. The buy-in is there. And I understand, you know, if Marty doesn't want to spearhead this, she's retiring and walking out the door. Nobody wants to start instituting new positions and then leave 6 to 8 weeks later. So it's just a bad situation. So I go back to my original statement to you. What do I do as your department head? Do I take a step back, or do I continue what I believe is in the strength of the community?
We have a comment or question from...
Has the schools historically, at the end of the fiscal year, had any surplus?
Yes.
I don't know.
Yes.
Of course they do. That's why they have an E&D fund. The E&D fund, they can have up to 5% of their budget, and then over 5% they have to give back.
They have had a substantial surplus at the end of every year?
The Frontier has. The elementary school seems to use it all up.
Is there any way of reducing the budget and going back and putting it forward as an article on the next special town meeting? And I'm sure that it would pass, but force Frontier to use their reserves. If they're so supportive of this position, to go back to them whenever this initial monies start to run out, they look at, we're at the point now, we need $20,000 to finish off this year. Where's it going to come from? You have to come up with tunnels and bring it back up at a later point in time. I know it's not the best scenario, but it may be a way to keep the position going for a while and try to work out a compromise on this. Because there is a guarantee he's got 100% support. And I also understand that you as a committee have to answer the dollars and cents. And I respect for it, and I would expect nothing less of you. But unfortunately, all these issues, ambulance, police department, everything else, too much emotion is brought in on the town floor, and your job has to be without emotion. And I do respect you for that. And unfortunately, too many people point fingers. But is this a possible way of, well, I hate to say kicking the can down the road, but it seems like you're pretty much at a standoff right now.
Well, I think that's a very good point you bring up, and to throw out a hypothetical, and maybe we can go back and figure out where some of these things won't work. But to the extent, John, that you could continue the position in the course it is now, funded as it is now through the end of the school year, which is FY16 anyway, then we have the summer. If we're having a special town meeting sometime in the fall, you know, I don't know how that salary load will affect you in the summer, being that school will be out of session, but there may still be some things that that resource officer may need to do that are happening on school grounds, where you would have the ability to go back to a special town meeting in the fall, having had the conversations with the new superintendent. And I think to the extent, you know, that we needed more input from other boards and committees, people are so willing to do it and have a more unified plan at that point in time. Is that...
that point in time, the free cash would be recertified as well.
There'd also be the reserve fund to the extent that they needed something else.
Right. Sometimes that reserve fund gets pretty low.
Right.
But I'm just saying, at that point, you should have free cash recertified at that point in time.
When did we get free cash certified this year? September?
It was late.
September, October timeframe.
It's usually early October. Yeah, now that we've got the new computer system online.
October, somewhere around there.
Yep. So let's say end of October to be conservative. So you'd be talking about a couple months into the next school year where you may have had to provide this service and juggle similarly to how you've had to this year. What do you think of that, just general or any of the specifics that do or don't work?
Here's my concern with that.
Sure.
The residents have expressed dissatisfaction about any of us not representing the true facts at annual town meeting. Mm-hmm. The residents in this town do not like anything other than emergency or last minute items put on the fall special town meeting. So now what's going to happen is same thing as a cruiser 3 years ago. The finance committee, the board of selectmen went to annual town meeting and said, we are putting a car on the fall after free cash is certified. The residents still flipped out. And I got the pushback all across town. I don't like it. I like everything above board. I like it clean. Here's the budget as a whole. This is what's happening. And these are the schools that are currently supporting it. And we are working on the MOUs right now. So that way it's crisp. It's clean. We have the buy-in. And I can tell you that Doug and I will be communicating with Frontier and Deerfield Elementary throughout the fall. Mm-hmm. But I think it's a lot cleaner that way. I don't like to postpone and play the 23 and a half hour rule. It just doesn't work in our favor. It makes me almost look dishonest, and I don't like that. So.
And I would agree with you totally, because I'm one of the ones that are very adamant about having a lot of stuff brought up at special town meeting. However, if this is brought up
at
regular town meeting, that there will possibly be an article at the special town meeting, then you put it out to up front, right up front, where everybody can sit and stew for the summer.
I don't disagree at all, but they don't remember in the fall.
Well,
no, they don't.
That's exactly what happened.
I agree with John on this one. It's just
Can Frontier put an article on the warrant asking for funds from their surplus?
If Frontier wants to take funds out of their surplus, their END, I think the chief actually mentioned school choice money, which I think could be expended without with approval by the school committee, but without town meeting approval. They can expend from school choice.
That should be the revenue source.
That should be the revenue source.
Well, I don't want to speak for other people's revenue sources and budget decisions. Right. And again, I think that, to me, if we talk about whether it's the summer or the next year, that a time period to work between John and the new superintendent to understand exactly how this is going to work in terms of the role, not only the funding, is a very important step that we would very much like to do in the sequence that it would normally be done. These are a number of good ideas. I do keep coming back to, I do think that annual town meeting this year is a good place to have this conversation. I do think, as it stands, this is a line item that I am leaning towards not recommending, but being very willing to have that debate on town floor and make our, as was said, unemotional comments on why we saw it the way we did, and understand that at town meeting, very often a more emotional position will often carry and can and maybe should.
I was just going to say, a moment ago, you had said how, Deerfield had put this money forward and maybe there were some other schools that might. And a thought on that is that, maybe they would, and I don't expect them to, but if they did, it might fund it. But the problem I still see is I want to see the school board buying in. If it gets covered financially by somebody else, it's easy. But I would like to see them. I mean, I'm hearing the words that they buy in, but yet a whole year's gone by, and maybe that's our fault or somebody's fault that they didn't put it right in front of them, but it didn't get in the budget. And I'm just afraid of, I just think it's really super important that everybody emotionally buy into this whole thing.
My biggest concern is the fact that Frontier is four towns.
Yes.
And Deerfield is carrying the share again. And that's one of the things I think will be brought up. I'm sure it will
be. Needs to be pointed out, clearly, yeah.
Well, I think that's why the importance of having part of it come through the school budget. Yeah. Is key to this whole thing, would be very helpful to convince everybody.
What's Deerfield's percentage of Frontier's budget?
About 48%.
48%?
Yeah.
So of the $12,000 we're looking for, we would be looking for the $6,000 from Conway, Sunderland, and Whately.
Yes. And to be clear, we're not sitting here talking about this because of just of $6,000, right?
No, right.
This is about a process. Very important that it's a collaborative effort. And I think that you would want us to be just as vigilant if some other department was going to send somebody into the police force to do something to make sure that you were on board.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's where, we're kind of a little bit in the middle here.
No, I don't disagree whatsoever. Like I said, I've stated my position.
And yeah. I appreciate that.
Yeah. To me, I think it's short money when it comes to the possible investment, and it's immeasurable.
I think we agree, but it's money.
All right, so Doug, we have a police payroll budget right now, as requested, of $751,466.
Okay, and that is putting, 751466, correct?
Yeah, that's what I say. Okay. Yeah. And what would the number be if we took out
4,000 less than that? 711.
Well, that'd also be adjustments to Quinnville and OT, right?
Yeah.
Because those were revised because of.
I'm going to need help here then, Chief. If this is the ninth position we'd add, okay?
Mm-hmm.
So if that goes in. 49.9.
Yeah, we're going to have to take out 5,200 from the Quinnville.
Okay.
Yep. So right back to 49.9. And then I think we put in minuscule overtime, maybe $3,000.
Yeah, it was 24,150. I think it was only $2,000.
I'm not really struggling with it because I see
basically
the value of it. I wrote firsthand.
Yeah.
Of it.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah. That makes sense because that's what it was 2 years ago.
So then that number minus that position, 704.
So much else.
114.
Okay.
That's excluding
from here to the
Quinn. Mm-hmm. What
yes.
else?
So the Quinn, and I think $2,000 or $3,000 in overtime and the base funding in the position. So all three of those.
Okay.
Now, to my knowledge, if we present that lower number on town meeting, we can't bring the number up.
That number will be presented either way. It'd be the recommended amount would be the only thing that changes. Is that correct, Doug?
Yeah, your requested amount would still be
the requested amount would still be the
both the requested and the recommended amounts will appear on the finance committee report.
Right.
The finance committee's recommended amount will probably be the one that's read.
Okay.
The town meeting, broadly speaking, has the ability to go with either the recommended or the requested.
So there's nothing
they
prohibiting
can't go above the original request.
They can't go above the original requested, right. So nothing prohibiting either of those numbers from being what's voted. Okay. All right, well, unless anybody else has anything further to say, I think it's come time to vote on this one way or the other.
Is that
50? Anyone else care to make a comment?
One question I have that I just thought of. I know the resource officer that we're discussing. Is there any conflict of interest there? Because I do know that person.
I think we all do.
No, unless you're a direct relative, there's no conflict of interest.
Okay.
If it's your son or daughter or nephew, yeah.
Just
check knowing somebody
to make
may
sure.
have a conflict, we couldn't get anything.
That's true. Right. Well, I just wanted to make sure because.
No, that's. Yeah. Fair.
It has to be an immediate relative there to be a conflict.
Yeah. Okay.
Okay. Well, I would open up if anyone would like to make either motion for the 751466 or the 704114. I'm happy to vote my opinion on either amount.
Let me ask a question again. If we went with the requested amount, the 751466, any town resident could bring that to the floor and challenge that.
Challenge
to
it.
Go down to the
to go down
yes.
to the
yeah. So
number.
If the requested amount that will be maybe not read but brought to town meeting will be the 751466 as requested by John and as part of Doug's budget or the administrator and select board's budget. Regardless of the number that we recommend here, it can be amended to either one. It cannot go above 751466 in any case, but can go anywhere from that number down
all the way down
yep. any number yep. people would like.
And it could be also adjusted on the floor for. Like,
well, that's. I mean, it's going to be right.
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 If you want to gauge the importance of this to the town, recommend a lower amount, and then the chief or selectman will have the opportunity to stand up and say, "No, we want this funded."
Right.
And then folks can decide, weigh in.
I think the key is the discussion. I think people need to know what's happening.
I do too.
I agree.
I think that's very
well, people are going to ask anyways. There's a $50,000 increase in the police budget. I would expect that they put a hold on it.
Those do get noticed.
Yes.
Yeah.
So.
Well, anyway.
Yeah.
Okay. Well.
Yep.
I will go forward and make a motion for the 704114.
I'll second that.
All right. It's been seconded. So this is to. Recommended amount of 704114, which is the payroll, police payroll budget without the school resource officer and the other small adjustments made to overtime pay and Quinnbill. All those in favor?
Aye.
I'm going to abstain.
Okay.
I'm abstaining.
So 4-0 and 2 abstentions.
Mary, did you vote in favor?
She did. So, John, I'd like to speak for myself, and I thank the entire board that we very much appreciate the job that you and the police force do. We very much look forward to this conversation on town meeting floor. We think this is a very important conversation for the town to have, and I'll speak for myself here. It'd be very easy to just say yes and go along. This is not an easy thing to do.
I'm not offended, not in the least. Yeah.
Yeah. So.
Well, we're not offended by anything.
Right.
For the police department thing. It's the whole process. Okay. Again.
There are a number of budget issues where things get into columns where they really shouldn't be there, or they should be shared among others. And this will be one of them.
This is a big, important conversation we need to have. And to your point, we'd have it either way. Mm-hmm. I do agree with that. Well, if there's anything else we can do to communicate our feelings or to exchange more information in preparation of town meeting, feel free to reach out, and we'll certainly do likewise.
Well, I think the only thing the finance committee can do is actually reach out to either the principals or the superintendent and figure out where their actual position is. Has it varied? Because
I did today.
Okay.
I spoke to Marty.
Okay.
And what was her? She emailed me.
Today. What was her position today?
I read portions of what she had communicated to me, which was, having gone through there was not a memorandum of understanding that they had been looking to get the exemption from it a year ago when they thought it was both created and funded, and that, it being last minute was certainly a challenge to supporting it, but not, obviously she didn't go to so much to say that she couldn't support it under any circumstance on any time, and to your point earlier, I think the real decision maker on this is going to be her replacement. So I think it's going to be an important conversation for you to have with that person, regardless of what we do with her now or at town meeting in a couple of weeks. But I did want to try to close the gap a little bit. And I also spent some time looking at Mass General laws about the way that this position is supposed to be set forth, just so that we could, again, look towards that direction as well, because we all are trying to do the best we can and want to make sure we do the work that we can.
Yeah, I just want to make sure we're all on the same page. Yeah.
And hopefully by town meeting we will be. And if everybody stands up and everyone's in unison and away we go, no one will be happier than me.
Mm-hmm.
Honestly.
Good.
So.
It would help me a lot if a school committee representative got up and spoke in favor of it and committed to budget some of it the following year.
But again, to be fair, there's the agreement that gets put in place of what this really means, what it's doing. I think that's where this really begins. I think that's what you certainly will be spending time already and continuing to do. And obviously, many people may stand up and say that they support it in concept, but that's the problem. It's the in concept part. We got to get down to the in actual part of what it's going to mean and what it's going to do, how this person's going to split their time among 4 to 7 schools, depending on what other grammar schools end up doing, and going from that, it's 5 to 7, 4 to 8 schools. Anyway. Thank you very much for coming in. If there's anything else you'd like to add or ask us, feel free.
No, is there any other questions?
No, I don't think for now. I may follow up if we have any, and thank you for coming in.
Great, thank you. You need me for anything? Okay, good.
Sorry to interrupt your evening. All right, moving on. The next budget that we were going to be discussing, and I think, Doug, this is one you were going to be, the next couple you're going to be leading the discussion on. The first one was the selectmen staff salaries. That was budget number 122-5100.
I'm sorry, what was that number again?
5110. Selectmen staff salaries. We started talking about this last week. And did not get through it. I think Doug was going to be, you had said you maybe either wanted to talk with the select board or get more info. I'm not sure. And I think the questions that I had raised had to do with the addition of the committee clerk position.
My understanding is that this finance committee does not want to add positions. If that still holds true, I'm willing to remove that position.
Okay.
the bulk of what that person would do would be to support the planning board. By removing that position, I will probably be speaking with John Waite to talk with how the planning board will continue from this point forward.
What has been done over the past year?
What has been done over the past year is I, in my role as executive assistant, have gone to the planning board meetings and have done the paperwork for them, which is why I, in my role as executive assistant, worked about 46 to 50 hours a week, claiming overtime only when I could.
And the executive assistant position will be filled, potentially?
That position, I do have a person in that position, yes.
Right.
Grade 3, step 1. That person is still learning.
Okay.
Who is the executive administrator?
Sorry?
You have a person in the executive?
That executive assistant is not filled right now. There's a person in a temporary position. I'm hoping she will apply for the executive assistant position because she's working out very, very well. If in order for her to make the transition from the part-time temporary position she is in now to anything else, the position has to be opened up and advertised.
But you've got it set up. Grade 3, step 1, right?
The executive assistant, yes.
Mm-hmm. So is there anybody that would like to advocate on the committee would like to advocate for retaining or adding the committee clerk position? That was my feeling last week, or when I saw this budget, was I understand that Doug has had a huge workload. I understand that the temporary help in the exec assistant position will help alleviate some of that, but maybe not all of that. And as he and that person is stabilized in their roles and potentially become full-time in those roles, there may be a time in next year's budget where we contemplate having to add something like this. But for me, right now, I'd rather, I think discretion is a greater part of valor on this budget.
Revised request 138873.
Anyone like to make a motion for that revised amount of 138873?
I'll make a motion.
Thank you.
I'll second.
Thank you. All those in favor?
Aye.
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 Any opposed or abstaining? No. Okay. All right, thank you, Doug. The next, I guess, two budgets, which we have not discussed yet, summer swim program is 630-5400.
What do you have for a bottom line on that budget, please?
Let's see.
Oh, summer swim, I'm sorry. I don't think that's changed.
What is that number again?
630-5400. I have a number of $11,040. And I think as I've related to the committee, but I'd made some attempts to try to learn more about this budget, had been unsuccessful, and we'll be leaning a lot on Doug here to help guide us on, you know, what some of these numbers have looked like in the past, what sort of responses he's gotten to this and the Tri-Town Beach budget as well. And he's grabbing a piece of paper, and we'll be back in a moment.
Based on the questions that I've received about both this program and the other, I actually asked our town accountant to go back for about 3 years to make a review of the appropriations for the Tri-Town Beach and the swim program. I'm just quickly checking. That doesn't follow. It's interesting because the numbers I have don't follow. I'm looking at summer swim program. I'm looking at a request of $11,000.
We have 11,040.
Yep, 11,040.
I mean, on the budget, it has, you know, 6770 for FY15 expenditures. I don't know if that ties out with things you'd seen.
Okay. So this is going to be confusing because both the summer swim program, the Tri-Town Beach, have been rolled into, as far as I can tell, one line item in our accounting system, and I'm not sure why that is the case.
Mm-hmm.
should not be doing that.
No, it shouldn't be doing that.
Definitely not.
The summer swim program is Deerfield only. Tri-Town Beach is Tri-Town Beach.
Okay.
Deerfield, sure.
Okay, no, I guess I see what I'm looking at. I'm not looking at what was actually appropriated. What was appropriated over the past several years was about $9,000 in 2011, $10,400 in 2012, $10,700 in 2013, $10,700 in 2014, and $11,400 for the past 2 years, with a request again of $11,400. In 2013, total expenditures from the swim program were $7,383. In 2014, $7,781. In 2015, $6,769. And in 2016, $5,940. In those same years, there were revenues that went from $2,250 in 2013 to $1,170 in 2016. In other words, the revenues dropped by about half. Now, there is slightly over $10,000 in the revolving fund for the swim program that has not been used, with the exception of a single expense in 2013, reimbursement to an individual for expense in the amount of about $400. So the revolving fund continues to take the revenues from the swim program, I assume for lesson fees and that sort of thing, and continues to add them in at a rate of at least $1,200, if not more, per year. The expenses, mostly due to payroll, is only at about $6,000 at the most. Last year, there was an unexpected expense because they bought new chairs for the beach, I guess.
Okay.
That was about $1,600 all told, but that was a one-time expense. So there you are.
So there's 10,000 sitting in there now?
There's 10,000 in a revolving fund now, just slightly over, 10,000 and change.
Which revolving fund?
It's a revolving fund related to the swim program. Not talking about the beach, just the swim program. And apparently that's where all revenues are going.
Okay, I did not know that they had a revolving fund for that.
Yeah, apparently they do. At least that's my understanding.
I mean, my recommendation for this budget would be to recommend an amount of, say, $8,000, which seems to outpace the expenses that they've had. And to the extent we get more information about why an 11,000 number is needed, I'm certainly open to the conversation. But without any additional information, I have a hard time leaving this budget where it is based on what we have been able to find out.
So who do these... The swim people report to? I mean, who oversees them?
The swim program is overseen by the two representatives, or should be three representatives, from the town of Deerfield to the Tri-Town Beach program. My understanding, and I believe Mr. Pachorek will correct me if I'm wrong, my understanding is that for the Tri-Town Beach, there are three representatives from Deerfield and three from Whately.
Okay.
Three positions. Right now, there's only two from each town serving.
Okay.
For a total of four. The swim program is managed by the three representatives from Deerfield, those three commissioners from Deerfield.
Of which there's only two at the moment.
Currently, there's only two, yes.
And so obviously they're doing that on a volunteer basis.
Yeah. The commissioners are, yes.
Yes,
the instructors do get paid.
Right, yeah, I see that.
If it means anything, just a really quick analysis of the difference between the revenues and the salary costs between 2013 and 2016 suggests that there's a baseline of about $4,700 or $4,800 of expenses, and everything above that is covered by revenues, if that makes sense. So if you start with $4,800 that we appropriate, and they make $100, that means an additional $100 of expense. If they make $3,000, it's an additional $3,000 worth of expense. That being said, I wouldn't recommend funding them at $4,800 because I don't think they could make it work.
So. What do you think of a number like $8,000?
Sure. And if worse comes to worse, they do have the revolving fund that they can draw from.
Right.
So if suddenly we have 1,000 people wanting to learn how to swim this year,
right,
they can backfill fund to support the program.
And to be clear, I think the revolving fund existence and reason is a whole separate conversation. I don't think at least not my goal with this budget, is to force them to use it. It doesn't seem like they've needed to use it even at an 8,000 level. That's why I don't want to go to something like 5,000 and just say, well, they'll figure it out, because I don't think that's completely fair either.
No, I agree.
But you did say that their average sort of revenue is about 1,200 a year.
No.
At the lowest. 11. It was 1,200 last year.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Well, I'm sorry. It's 1,200 so far in FY16.
Right.
So that may go up to 13 or 14 this
so
year by the time we're
if we say $1,000 of revenue, and what's their average expense for salaries?
For salaries over the past, from 2013 to 2016, I'd say roughly about $7,000.
So 7,000 minus 1,000, they're spending about 6,000 a year.
Well, they're pocketing the one, to be strictly accurate, they're pocketing the 1,000. It's going into the revenue account, and they're spending 7,000 of appropriation.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right.
It's in a revolve. It's not going anywhere, but it's just going into the revolve.
So your 8 leaves a little cushion there.
I think this is more than a one step solution to what's going on in the budget, how to get it right.
I think
we're going to do some of it now, and then probably the rest of it in FY18.
Yeah.
Anyone like to?
I make a proposal 8,000.
Thank you.
Second.
Thank you. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. It's unanimous. All right, Doug, Tri-Town Beach, the next one, 630-5410. Obviously related to the previous one, a little bit different, as was mentioned, that Whately, the town of Whately, contributes to this budget as well. It looks to be about 23% of the budget comes from Whately.
And what do you have for a bottom line number?
For Deerfield's portion, 15,564.
564, okay. So I'm almost reluctant to hand this out, but I kind of want to have you have it anyways. The budget as presented to you includes basically costs for lifeguards, senior lifeguards, gatekeeper, maintenance person, and liability insurance of about $2,200, with a total of about $20,213, and of that, Whately pays about 23% mm-hmm. for that total. 15,564.
Right.
Okay. I did receive a listing of expenses that came from another account associated with the Tri-Town Beach. This is an independent account that is designed to manage the revenues from the beach and to pay for other expenses related to the beach. Essentially, it's a revolving fund in form. I'll leave it at that. It had a starting balance of $1,289 at the beginning of FY15. That was July 1st of 2014.
Sorry, $1,289?
$1,289. It had an ending balance of $1,553. So we're not dealing with a lot of money. Mm-hmm. Overall, overall the expenses were roughly about $4,000 and the revenues were roughly about $4,000, give or take a hundred or two.
Well-run program. Hmm.
I built a budget using those numbers, rounded up on some of these to the nearest 50, I think, and put it into a Tri-Town Beach budget. It's different from the one you have by $70. It's $70 less.
Okay.
However, the reason I wanted to give this to you is because I think it accurately reflects several things. It shows the estimated receipts. It brings them into the light.
Mm-hmm.
It shows the estimated expenses, which we've never seen before. And those expenses are legitimate. The water testing costs, printing, utilities, trash, insurance, South Deerfield Water. They have a bill for South Deerfield Water, so that's allocated in there. Salary for the accountant who manages this, and the permit for the year that they pay for through the town of Whately, plus the supplies line item, and about $400 for a staff picnic, I assume, at the end of the year. Overall, like I said, the line to the town of Deerfield is about $70 less than what you've got. But it is a verifiable record of expenses. So if you want to have this to take a look at.
Yeah.
No harm.
There it is. A couple of weeks ago, the Tri-Town Beach Commission, all four members currently sitting, met, reviewed the budget for salaries, agreed that the salaries, which include a 50-cent increase over last year, 50-cent per hour increase over last year, was fair. They believe they can find people to staff the beach for that. And
the budget, you mean this budget?
I mean, just the salaries part of the budget.
Okay.
That's what they voted to approve. So there's that. There are a number of questions that were asked by one of the commissioners from Deerfield, Beth Foley, as well as myself. We have not received answers to those questions. Some of them are, is there a cash handling policy? Do you expect to buy a cash register for the beach this year? My understanding is that up to this point, it's been a cash system that involves a cigar box and paper ledger, if that. I asked questions about how many people actually attended the beach, how many permits were sold, how many permits were sold to Waitley residents versus Deerfield residents, how many permits were sold to residents from other places. And I have not yet received those pieces of information. It was pointed out to me earlier this afternoon that doesn't indicate wrongdoing. The fact that we don't have those answers yet, it doesn't indicate malfeasance or anything along those lines. It indicates that we need to put more pressure on the commissioners to get those answers. And in turn, they need to put more pressure on the folks who are tallying number of permits sold and so on and so forth. There is no question about the record of the finances. Everything that has been spent is available for review. The receipts are available for review. And the record keeping has been solid up to this point. But it can certainly be improved. And I think it should be improved. That being said, I think that I would recommend with this budget approval, but with a very serious heads up or a warning, if you will, to the commissioners to basically put pressure on them to get things back in order. Because if we still have these same questions 10 months from now as we're looking at FY18, maybe the decision is going to be different at that point.
It's not healthy to go on like this.
Oh, it is not.
Anyone else want to agree with that or feel differently?
I agree with it, but I think that warning does need to be there. It's extremely important.
If you're totaling up and thinking, recommending things like a cash register, I don't see any expense for that.
True, I didn't add that in there. But again, they do have a checking account with money that they can expend from. Okay. That has about $1,500 in it. So if they choose to expend money for a cash register out of that account, I believe they can do that.
And do you feel comfortable, Doug, voting, and I know these are small numbers, but an increase to a budget that we feel this way about versus, say, flatlining from last year? I know you'd have to adjust a couple of figures. Do you feel strongly one way or the other? I know you spent some time, so to the extent that you do feel good about this budget, that certainly does resonate with me.
Yeah. Well, again, once again, I asked the town accountant to take a look at revenues versus expenses for the past 4 years for the Tri-Town Beach program. And in each year, let me just really quickly compare appropriations. Let me get to the right page, and I apologize for not being prepared. And in FY13, there was $14,238 requested. $14,217 was expended. FY14, $14,238 requested. $14,171 expended. FY15, $14,660 requested. $14,420 expended. And so far in FY16, $14,656 was requested, and $9,200 has been expended. In each of those years, about $4,800, so anywhere from $4,800 to $5,700 has been for services, with staffing going from $9,400 down to $7,100 so far this year. So staffing levels have actually been reduced, but expenses have actually increased over the course of those 4 years. This is the only thing that raises a significant red flag for me, because I know that last year, for at least several weeks, the beach was closed. Which means you don't need staff. Which means you don't need someone manning the gate. You don't need people, you know, acting as lifeguards. You don't need people there. And so if their staffing levels were lower, which I guess you could say they have been so far.
Yeah, that'd be pretty close.
What's part of the cost
exactly
that's not spent yet will be part of this year because that goes up to June 30th.
Right.
Yep, that's true.
It's coming up on. District.
Yep.
Reopen a beach, they have to turn around, set it up, get things organized and
sure.
functional again.
Sure.
Seasonal.
Yeah. So that's the only other question is there, were there similar times when the beach was shut down for a week or 2 weeks or 3 weeks in previous years? And if so, why did the budget get expended entirely? If we come to the end of this year, knowing that there was 3 weeks or so, let's say, where the beach was closed to the public.
Water quality.
Mm-hmm. For a long time.
When you've only got a 10-week season, that means 7/10 of your salary should not have been spent. And if so, why wasn't there 3/10 of your salary budget left in your budget at the end of the year?
Correct me if I'm wrong, but I think when they've had shutdowns for water quality before, it's really kind of a day-to-day thing, so they almost don't know 2 days out if they're going to open or not.
That's correct.
So right. They can't, you know, I don't know how they work
they
with
get
it.
The testing. If something comes back,
it says okay,
and there's too much bacteria in the water, then they have to shut down.
Right.
So they get people out, but you've already got the people in for the day working.
Right.
And then the question is, they may not take a test for another 2 days, and then what do they do with the people in between? I don't know what those
right.
policies are.
Yeah. Yeah.
They were shut down for quite a while this last summer, weren't they?
So they said 2 weeks.
Summer?
Yeah.
So now, Doug,
hey,
what? Oh, sorry.
She said they were shut down quite a while.
I have no idea what they were last year.
I don't know.
Thinking about the kids that were talking about swimming there.
Mm-hmm. I would need to go and talk with the health inspector for the town of Whately to find out exactly how long and when.
So oh, there is a small revolving fund associated with this, I think you said.
Is there?
Oh, I thought you said in the beginning.
There's one for the swim program. I don't know
no,
that
know
there's
that.
One for
what was the
this.
$1,200 to $1,500?
Well, that was
good. That was for the swim program.
No,
that was
the swim
for
Tri-Town
Beach.
Oh, I'm sorry. No, and it's not a revolving fund. It's just a checkbook that essentially accepts the receipts and expends money from it.
Okay, but so there are additional funds of some amount in that checkbook?
There are additional funds of some amount in that checkbook. It's about $1,500 right now sitting around.
Right, well.
About $300 more than they had from last year. The budget that I just distributed to you takes that into account. It doesn't take into account the $1,500, but it takes into account the revenues that would normally go into that checkbook.
Yeah. Right.
This is also one of the things that I think really, really needs to happen is that the financing for all of these expenses needs to come under a town's purview, either Whately or Deerfield, I don't care which.
Right.
I think it says something different in the bylaw. That's the problem.
What's that?
There's an issue in the bylaw that says it has to be maintained separately.
In which bylaw?
The Tri-Town Beach.
Okay, can you show me a copy of that?
I can't, but I can tell you that question's been asked
by
before.
State legislature.
In 1968, I think.
Yeah.
And I can't find.
Okay, and we do not have time for that story.
Yeah,
today.
No. I can't. The bottom line is I have no reference. I don't have the articles of incorporation or the paperwork which set up the district. So I don't have any information about that.
I think the question's been asked in the past, and I believe that was the answer, is that legislation was produced that said it had to be a separate account.
Okay.
Maybe
that is a
account.
Discussion for perhaps smarter people than I. If it's a district like the solid waste management district or that sort of thing, then all of the aspects, all of the costs of this should be put on the district to be managed on their own. It's not. We split the paycheck salaries between the two towns. We split the accounting, you know, if somebody claims 8 hours, 6 of it is paid for by Deerfield, 2 of it paid for by Whately with 2 separate checks. That's weird.
Right. So
especially when there's a third checkbook outside of either town for expenses.
I feel somewhat uncomfortable voting a budget increase for this budget given all the cost, even though, again, I think that we don't have a problem with what we're trying to do here and that there are legitimate expenses and costs, salary and otherwise. I'd feel much more comfortable voting the 14,656, same as last year, knowing that number one, there is these additional funds of $1,200 to $1,500, and also that to the extent that we get into an issue and they had to come back for reserve funds, I understand it's a little more complicated because it'd be both Deerfield and Whately, but we would certainly do our part to support that to the extent that they came back and demonstrated the need. It's, you know, it's a program, it's a it's something that we certainly can support, but this process here is tough for me to vote an increase given a lot of the other votes we're taking.
They increased
about $810.
Yeah, this isn't about, you know, dollar amounts. I understand that. This is about just trying to be consistent about how, at least I'm trying to be consistent with how I'm approaching all these budgets. It's been a difficult year, and
I'd say all this conversation came up after I first said I agree with what he's got, but all this discussion's been now just after that, so it changes the picture.
Sure.
Well, I mean, I'm just explaining. I'm agreeing with what you're saying, and I'm trying to explain why I'm changing positions, because when he first talked about it, it's like, yeah, it makes sense. But now we kept the conversation going on about uncomfortable areas, and it.
And I'm agreeing with you.
I
mean, this is why we have the conversation.
These folks just may need some support of somebody in accounting or something to help them. I mean, I don't know who they are or how, but, you know, we just may need to help them out with that.
I think you're right, Bill.
Well, to be fair, there's not a lot of extra hours floating around necessarily, yeah. So we're going to have to figure out something, and this is part of the challenge of having boards and commissions that really have to make real decisions or put together real information, and it's challenging to find enough people to do all the different things we have needs for in town. But
how much did we pay last year?
$14,656.
$14,656.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
And what is they asking for this year?
$15,494. Those are the Deerfield portions.
That's Deerfield portion.
Yep. Anyone feel strongly about either the requested or a level funded budget? Okay.
I already gave my
opinion. Yes. Would you like to make a motion to that?
If that's what you like, okay. I'll make a motion. Level right. Funded.
Okay. So Rouse made a motion for $14,656. Anyone like to second that?
I'll second it.
Second.
Thank you. All those in favor of a level funded budget of $14,656 for Triton Beach?
Aye.
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 Unanimous.
Yep.
All right. Thank you.
This is the kind of commission that's very for people. Mm-hmm.
They
might just get.
Okay. There are two more budgets we have, only two more individual budgets we have not voted, Frontier and Frontier Transportation. I would like to hold, and I really do not want to do this, but I would like to hold the Frontier budget to our meeting next week, because there is particular budget question that I have up that I've not been able to get an answer to. If people feel very strongly and would like to have the conversation, have a vote, I am open to it, but that would be my reason for wanting to put it off, even though I really did not want to have to do that. Anyone feel strongly about voting it tonight? I know, Doug, there's obviously advantages to doing it. We have the public discussion about the budget tomorrow night, but it's something I'd like to get an answer to so I can speak more with more conviction about the budget next week.
Okay.
All right. We could, however, vote transportation budget. It does not affect that one. That budget number is $315,5800.
Frontier transportation?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, I'm sorry. For some reason, I thought you were reading an amount. I'm like,
no.
Holy crap.
Yes, no. We're flying now.
Woo! Personal drone service for every child. Wow.
Sorry. A budget number, $315,5800. The requested amount is $40,529. And that is the Deerfield assessment portion of the transportation budget. Any questions on this one? Anyone like to make a motion for that amount?
So moved.
Thank you. Anyone like to second?
Seconded.
Thank you. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. With one abstention. Yes, taking a break. Okay. With that, we would look to be moving on to the warrant section of the evening. And Doug, I was going to start with the special town meeting warrant, unless you have an objection to that.
That's fine with me.
The first article, does everyone have a copy of the special town meeting warrant? They were passed out last week. Hopefully everyone kept it. So Article 1 has to do with the town funding any snow and ice deficit from FY16. Is there one, Doug?
At this point, my understanding is that there is not, or if there is one, it's extremely small.
Okay.
The Board of Selectmen authorized overspending that account back in February, but since then it hasn't snowed too much. So
right.
Hopefully we will come in within that. One thing I can tell you, though, is that, or remind you, I should say, is that the budget for next year includes an extra $2,000
right.
in the snow and ice budget, so we're requesting $85,000. I think you've already looked at that.
Yeah, now, that is separate. Obviously, that is separate from this, right? This is
completely separate from the special, okay. Yes. Sorry,
and this is just us voting to pay it if there is one. We don't even know what the amount would be.
Correct.
And is this something you'd like us to recommend or not? I mean, it is... I think we recommend paying our bills. I think we always do
right.
that.
If there is going to be, I can look to try to have a solid number tomorrow night if you'd like.
Right.
And I really should have looked at that this year
yeah.
or today. But I'm guessing it's going to be extremely small if it exists at all.
Sure. So but the problem being that there really wouldn't be another mechanism to pay this because this is FY16. This is the one mechanism to do this.
Right.
If we did not like the number that came forth, I would think the proper course would still be to pay this, but ask a lot of questions about how we're going to do this in FY17 if people were not happy with
that. You're
talking
about the snow and ice budget?
Yeah. Like
generally speaking, it's not even, it's just the cost of doing business.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
There is an opportunity to take no action, and we can wait until much later because the Finance Committee can always pay any cost overrun out of the reserve fund before the end of the year.
Okay.
If need be.
Well, then.
What I'd rather do is get a solid number on the day of town meeting
right.
and just bet that we won't be,
okay.
you know, have to pay for any snow plowing after May 1st.
I think I'd be leaning towards take no action as there isn't a specific number, and we certainly can speak to a specific number on town meeting if there is, and we certainly can take it up as a reserve account item if it is not passed at that time. Anyone object to that?
No.
Okay. Article number 2, this is to authorize the town to bill out for the FY16 South County EMS indirect cost number that has been agreed to by all sides. As we have gone through this budget and we do know this exact amount, I think this is something we certainly could speak to.
That doesn't clearly state what it's for because they have not paid 2015 and they have not paid 2016, and I see 2017's in their budget.
Well, this is 16, and actually, Doug, will it in the motion specify this as the FY16?
I'm sorry, Article 2?
2 from the special town meeting warrant.
I'm looking at that. Can you read the article that you've got in front of you?
To see if the town will vote to transfer $57,899 from the South County Emergency Medical Service Enterprise Fund retained earnings to the Town of Deerfield General Fund or take any action relative thereto.
Yep, the draft language for the motion is, I move the article.
We talked last
week. Doesn't say what year it's for.
The question is, will there be more specifics given as to what this is for?
They owe us for 2 years.
Okay.
2015, 2016.
Well, in that case, then the draft language of the motion is going to have to change. So the draft language for the motion would be, I move to transfer $57,899 from the South County EMS Enterprise Fund retained earnings to the Town of Deerfield General Fund for administrative costs related to the fiscal year 2016.
Yes.
Yep.
And then to the extent that people want to try to look to amend that for other years or other amounts, that conversation can be had. Right.
My only concern is this, that when we had Mark in here and Tom, and we asked them that question again, what about 2015? And Tom's answer was, well, you're going to have to be billed for 52% of it. So what difference does it make? You don't have to worry about it. And besides, Sunderland already sent in a check for $12,000.
But they got it.
But since no bill ever came in or went to them, they sent the $12,000 back to them. The bottom line is it's not a question of $12,000. It's not a question of 52%. It's a question of we provided all services for 2015, and we should get $57,899 for that year, and we should get another $57,899 for this year, for 2016.
Well, it would be less. It would be less because based on the way the indirect cost formula is set up, and I don't know if somebody's done this, but if you went and back calculated the FY15 number, it would probably be around 25,000, maybe 30.
Why do you say that?
Because they, to my knowledge, the way that this was discussed, the way that they calculated the indirect costs was, well, actually maybe because they still were budgeted for the amount, even if they didn't spend it, it would be higher.
Bottom line is that they had three town administrators when they finally got their act together and said, figure out a formula and then we'll turn around and take it up and vote.
Right.
They finally did it in January this year or December last year?
It was completed around November. Yeah.
November last year. So they finally got it done and said, this is the base amount for each year. So if that's the base amount for each year, we should have one payment for 2015 and another second payment for 2016.
It's not going to be the same number every year. It's a calculation. The result of that calculation for FY16 was $57,899.
That is the same for every year.
I don't believe so. The result of that
calculation. Why wouldn't it be?
Because it's a function of the...
That's right.
It's a function of the cost of payroll.
Yeah.
It's a function of cost of payroll. Does that mean since they fired four more people, since we did the formula, it's going to go up next year? Because they don't have it budgeted yet. My understanding was that they were coming up with a thing saying, this is a typical year, this is the budget figure, this is for each and every year from now on.
That is not my understanding.
I don't think so. I think it's supposed to be calculated on what the budget is for that year.
Who's going to do that? The first full year, nobody did anything. They sat on their hands and didn't figure anything out. So all of a sudden, we're trying to play catch-up, and all I'm saying is whatever they figured out for 2016, they should pay the same thing for 2015, and they already got the same budget for 2017.
Yeah,
so I don't see a change in it at all.
Well, you're correct. The FY16 and FY17 numbers are the same. I do not know if they were not able to back-calculate, and so they just used the FY17 number to be the same as 16 or went the other way around. But my understanding is that it was a calculation that it would not be the exact same amount every year.
I never got that inclination from anybody. I don't know where that came from.
Well, because I think what they were trying to accomplish is let's say that the South County EMS budget gets cut in half next year, or let's say that all other functions of town double next year. Well, then the percentage of hours spent towards working on them as a percentage of the expenses spent in the town or salaries or whatever appropriations you want to look at, that dynamic changes. And so that's, I thought, why they came up with that
calculation. I don't think they ever set up anything to make changes other than come up with one figure, one annual cost, and that's what it's going to be forever from now on.
That year, they talked about finding a formula out of three choices or something.
Well, they did find a formula.
Yep. Right.
And this is a number they came up with.
But they won't know the fiscal 2017 until the end of the year.
Why would they put in the same figure for next year if they don't know what the formula is?
They won't have a number until the end of the year.
It may be a result of actual...
They got the number in there.
Not if it's a result of actual expenditures. Right? Because then you would just have the budgeted amounts. I'm trying to find... I know we were passed this out at some point. Sorry, in my...
But your basic premise is that Deerfield went a whole year working on this and never got reimbursed.
Right.
For that first year.
And we've already gone 1 year and three quarters into the second year and still haven't gotten reimbursed. This is the first sign of a reimbursement.
I agree with you on that first year. It was always talked about, we're going to take care of it, but it just
We
never...
asked them when they came to us a year ago. What are you doing? And my comment to them was, put in $25,000 or $35,000. Mm-hmm. And Skip's comment was, put in $50,000. I don't care what it was. I just wanted to get something done and paid so it was over and done with. But they never did nothing.
Yeah, that's kind of my feeling.
The amount
might be up in the air, but certainly there's some amount.
Yeah, some amount would have been justified.
No.
And I didn't know how to calculate it myself, so I wasn't going to even get into the calculations.
Right.
I just wanted to get something for the town because we did it.
It was the third one out of the...
I remember you distinctly saying that. Well,
yeah.
Like 25 or 30 or something.
Yeah. But, well, 25, 35,
I mean, it wasn't our position to calculate it, but whatever.
No.
Now, do you have the page with the calculation of that amount? Can you speak to this? I'm trying to find it.
I am also trying to find that.
I found the one for FY16 that used portions of the accountant's salary, the town clerk's salary, the assistant town clerk's salary, the assistant treasurer collector's salary, the town administrator's salary, the executive assistant's salary, as well, and took those as a percentage of the expense of the town. Then took the cost of the EMS salaries as a percentage of the town.
The budgeted amounts or the expended amounts?
The proposed budgeted amounts. And in all cases, it was the budgeted amounts for, or the proposed budgeted amounts for all these positions. And basically, the bottom line explanation is South County EMS is this percentage of the town's budget. Therefore, we take that same percentage of these other positions and turn it into a dollar amount.
Yeah,
the FY16 calculations actually came up with a number that was slightly under 52,000, like 51,559. The FY16 calculation, or I'm sorry, that was FY16. The FY17 calculation that was being worked on in November would have come up with something about like that. But there was a second methodology, which I'm not familiar with, which came up with like $90,000. The third methodology, which was the one that was chosen, was basically to take 10% of the EMS salary line items and call that the administrative cost. And that, my understanding is that's how they came up with the 57,990.
Of the budgeted salary line items?
I couldn't tell you exactly where it came from. I think it did not include overtime. I think that was salary. It could have been salary and insurance for the regular full-time positions. And that's how they came up with the 57.
Okay. And so I guess the question then would be why it did not change from FY16 to FY17.
That's what it is for FY17, is the 57,899, okay. I think.
But that's,
I think we're carrying, that's right. That's what's in the budget for right. The FY17 budget.
Right.
And I think we're simply using that number for FY16. If we wanted to go back and use the same methodology, that number would probably be lower by 1,000 or two.
Okay.
So
is that, we think that's the case, or we know that's the case?
I'm surmising. Okay. I wasn't present for any of these negotiations.
Fair enough.
So I'm just relying on the bottom line numbers and trying to pull from recall exactly what I've got.
Okay.
I recall some of that you're stating there, Doug. So in general, I think you're correct.
Thanks. Appreciate the lifeline. Yeah.
Would anybody opposed to holding off on this until we can verify those two amounts? Because if that is the case, if the 57,899 is the calculation for FY17, and that's what's in the budget, and then that was decided to be used for FY16, when I think we would agree a calculation by that amount would be lower because there are different raises and increases in the budget, then in that case, I would be supportive of this as the FY16 bill to be sent out, understanding that there's a separate issue of FY15, which that doesn't mean that shouldn't or couldn't be taken up or amended, but that is not part of this budget. And this part, I'd like to get one thing done.
Yeah.
And if we need to work on the second thing, we can work on the second thing.
I think that's clear what you're saying.
But I would like to confirm that. So rather than us put Doug on the spot, which is unfair because he was not part of the creation of that formula, and unfortunately we can't seem to find the results of that information right on our fingertips, let's move on from that one for now.
We have it, but it's just I don't have it right here. So,
yeah.
Article number 3 is about the energy loan payoff, which we did discuss and recommend paying off, but we had not articulated last week a revenue source, and I would like to come back, and I don't know if we need to do this for the article or just for the record, to suggest or recommend a revenue source in addition to paying it off. I feel that free cash is the better place for this money to come from. I understand that even with other recommendations or requested amounts being voted, this may leave us lower than our typical target for free cash. But as I look at the one-off revenues coming into local receipts, I think this is one of the only ways we can make sure that those one-off revenues are being used for one-off expenses like this one.
I'll second that. I really feel strongly this is where it should come from.
Okay, before
the only problem is we need to know how much we're going down to free cash. Because you're going to pay off $275,000, and you only got a $500,000, you're going down to $225,000.
Well, we know as of last week, if every budget that is requested, which they cannot go higher than that, is accepted at town meeting, and even if every recommendation lower is overturned at town meeting, that would leave us, including $100,000 of stabilization, with, I believe, $275,000, thereabouts. So to the extent that we're a little bit concerned about that, we could not put the $100,000 into stabilization, and that would leave us at $375,000. even using free cash to pay this off, and even assuming that every requested budget is passed.
So we'll have $375 left in free cash, as close as you can figure.
As a minimum, as close as I can figure, would be $375, assuming we do not recommend the $100,000 to stabilization.
That's going to be about three. Right now, I'm holding back $625,445 worth of free cash.
Okay.
That's pocketed away.
Okay.
Okay. Going back to the summary sheet, let me go down to the bottom. So that was 625. Assuming that that's being reserved, just held over here in hand, not being spent.
Okay.
Assuming we don't put anything to stabilization, and assuming we pay the energy loan from stabilization, that leaves us with that leaves us with a deficit of 56,000. So I think, do I have that right?
Could we do this another way? Because that's very confusing, I think.
We can do it either way you'd like. If you want it out of stabilization, or if you want it out of free cash, it's no skin off my teeth.
If you assume every requested budget is passed as submitted, and no money is sent to stabilization, and free cash is used to pay off the energy loan, in that case, how much free cash are you left with?
Give me a moment.
My cuff was about $376,000.
78.
Removing stabilization as a funding source, removing the hold on free cash, it leaves us $292,885 in free cash.
And that's including not sending $100,000 to?
There's nothing being sent anywhere.
What was the total now?
292,885.
Now, last week, when we went through the budget overview, we had $268,000 in cash. Assuming $100,000 transfer to stabilization and then everything else I just described.
Hmm.
So I'm curious.
The difference probably is because I put the $72,000 back into the capital request for the John Deere tractor. It was pulled. Because I had requested Kevin defer it to fall. However, if we don't want to make capital expenditures in the fall, then I'd rather make this happen at town meeting.
Okay. So that's if we back that back out, then we would be back in the 375 range.
364, but yeah.
Okay. So
the tractor was approved by CIPC for what it's worth, which is why I did put it back in there.
Okay.
The tractor was approved?
It was approved. They actually said yes. It was an expense they agreed with.
Okay, so you would be at around 370,000 or 300,000 if we also funded the tractor. Now that would also be at a minimum to the extent that any budgets are voted lower, some of which we've recommended lower, then that number would go up by those amounts. Yes, Bruce. Sure. That was one that we have to take action on. So that has been rolled over for 5 years using short-term funding. At this point, it needs to either be paid off or bonded. So that is an option. They're actually making some changes to the Municipal Modernization Act. We'll change that to a 10-year term, but it's kind of too late for us to utilize that. So we understand that we may not be exactly optimizing interest payments, but rather than try to refund this and pay off that and go through multiple iterations of refinancings, and I'm not sure what costs associated with those, we thought this was the cleanest way to contemplate what we want to do with this loan, and we have to take some action, as I said, because we can no longer roll it over on a one-year funding as we have.
Well, they are over 20 years, I think. Yeah.
Mm. Well, as we looked at this, and this goes back a couple months, and Bill and Jeff looked into this as well for us and reported back, it seems like a better job potentially could have been done to identify where those savings may have been and have those negative expenses contribute towards the repayment of this loan, maybe at least the interest or the, you know, something. And it does not appear that that was done, and it doesn't seem that it's feasible to do that at this point. Looking backward. So
if we go back and we take a look at some of the energy modifications that were done, There were, this loan helped to pay for changes to the controls at the Deerfield Elementary School, which it was estimated to save about $1,300 per year in electricity costs. It paid for what are called variable frequency drive motors for the air handling system at the elementary school. That was estimated to save about $11,000 per year.
Those are things, the motor changes are a known thing going in day one. You know what you're going to save on those motors?
Yep, based on previous use and so on and so forth. We did, we shut off a number of streetlights. Streetlight modification saved an estimated $9,000 per year, every year, and our streetlight budget went from $4,500 down to, or $4,800 down to $48,000 down to $35,000 in, when that happened. So there's that. So that's about $21,000 or $22,000 per year that this has helped to you know, benefit the town.
And Bruce, the other challenge that we find back to, like, on the budget side of this rather than the project side is, you know, I didn't think it was healthy to have a $900,000 free cash jump and to be starting this budget season with $1.4 million in quote-unquote free cash. I think it makes it very challenging to run the budget process. And you know, I think that we're trying to take some steps to not have such big jumps. And I think that we're forecasting to have another such increase when we certify free cash in September. And so, you know, without that fact pattern, I would have more concern about taking free cash down to, let's say, a minimum of $300,000. But that's kind of one way that I get comfortable with it. Right. There's some components on the revenue side, and there's some component that's on the expenses side. Our hope this year, at least my hope for the finance committee and the budget process as a whole across the town, was to try to push it forward to give us more time to be able to do things like that. And I don't know that we have those numbers yet. I know Doug was working on that. Numbers like that haven't informed our decisions on budgets this year, but I think they'll absolutely be a part of FY18. And this is kind of that bridge year where we're trying to get into that sort of a process.
You know, the building expense, you know, income and things like that go into free cash too if they're over. The building receipts that come in, those go into free cash also after the expenses. So,
you know, and all the local receipts you're having to exercise on a, you know, some sort of look back average, and it's challenging to want to. You don't want to estimate 100% of what you got last year because it may just, you know, people may buy new cars. So there's some of it is certainly from that. And I think it's healthy to have some increase from when you close the books to when you certify. But that seems like a little too much to be healthy.
Yep. Yeah.
Right. But the special town meeting has historically been one place where, you know, monies have been spent, and certainly people have, you know, argued why in non-emergency situations it's better to have it in the full town meeting for it. Yep. So I believe it was made and seconded, but we're having discussion about, right?
It
was made and seconded, right? I didn't imagine that. Is there any more discussion that people would like to have about recommending using free cash as a source to pay off the energy loan?
I just feel uncomfortable getting it down to $300,000, that's all. That's my only concern.
Yeah, and that's the hard part, because obviously we're recommending budgets that would leave it higher than that, but those may not be passed.
Yeah.
So that is certainly a difficult part here. But again, to the extent that it, you know, we felt that way, that's where an item like the tractor that was added late in the game, to the extent that we don't recommend that. But again, I guess, is that going to be part of the official request then? Is that
the tractor is, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, and it was actually part of a capital request that was submitted by Kevin in November.
Right, and it was just, when it came to us, it was dropped, and it said it was going to be delayed.
Put on as a delay, but based on the fact that folks are steering away from making any expenditures of money at a special in the fall, which I don't disagree with, I wanted to at least give it a good shot of getting funded, because...
I'm sorry?
No. The energy loan comes due. We have to either bond for it or pay it off in either late May or early June, which is why this is being done.
Why it's on the
special. Correct. Yes. Well, yes,
that's why
exactly.
It's on the special town meeting warrant.
Right.
Sorry, I should have clarified that.
So it's going to be expended in FY16. Yeah. Yep.
So we never did vote yet.
We have not yet voted. It is still open for any other discussion if people would like to make a case to not use free cash and rather to use stabilization to fund this payoff. And again, Doug, how will this work at town meeting in terms of there'll obviously be a vote to pay it off or not? Will there be a separate vote as to the source or?
No, there's going to be two motions. My understanding from Brenda is that there has to be two motions. The first actually has to be to rescind the remaining borrowing authority.
Right.
Because the amount that we owe is not the total amount that town meeting gave authority to borrow. So that's the first thing. It's to rescind the remaining borrowing authority. I don't have that amount yet. It doesn't matter. We haven't borrowed it. We just have to not let people borrow it from this point forward.
Right.
And then it will be a simple motion to take from free cash $275.7 to fund full repayment of the loan. Boom. That's it.
And what if at town meeting someone wanted to amend that, and for reasons we're discussing now, to use stabilization instead? Could that amendment be made?
Sure.
Yeah.
And
they could have 2/3 vote.
It would. Yeah, I was going to say it would change it to a 2/3 vote requirement, and then I would strongly advise a count of the votes.
What would that leave us in the stabilization fund?
Slightly under $1 million, I believe. I believe there's about 1.2 in there now.
Finance committee recommend considering taking half out of each fund.
Out of what?
Taking half from each fund. Oh. That may complicate the vote.
Yeah.
It would be, yes, no.
Yeah.
Right. Right. Mm-hmm. The unfortunate aspect is if we knew some of the results of the other budget votes in the end, that may result in us being in a different position on free cash, but we won't know that until we vote them. Mm-hmm. Doug, could we split the source between free cash and stabilization?
Sure. This is one of those things where it's entirely up to the Finance Committee to make a recommendation.
Okay.
The Board of Selectmen recommend paying it off, but you guys determine where the money comes from.
Okay. So how about if the $100,000 from stabilization, that would leave, assuming everything else passed as requested, and the tractor being added, would leave a lowest amount of $400,000.
And $175,700 from free cash. Okay. 2/3 majority required.
How do people feel about that?
That's good.
Yeah, fine.
I feel good about that. Excellent suggestion, Bruce.
Yeah.
Thanks, Bruce. All right, so first, I think we either have to withdraw the motion for the free cash or vote it down. Who made the motion originally?
You did.
I did. What an idiot that guy is.
No, that's
my motion.
I will withdraw my motion to recommend using free cash to fund this, and I will resubmit a motion to use $100,000 from stabilization and the balance from free cash in order to repay the energy loan.
Second.
$175,700.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. All right.
That's
good. Unanimous.
Yeah, that was unanimous.
Yeah.
$100,000 from free cash, right?
$100,000 from stabilization.
$100,000 from stabilization.
Yeah.
Okay.
And a balance from free cash.
Yep.
Okay. Article number four, it relates to municipal building fund capital projects. So these are the capital projects that we discussed that will be funded from the municipal building reserve fund. These projects are the Tilton Library carpet replacement, the Tilton Library air conditioner replacement, the town office fire detection system upgrade, the town office door replacement, the town office rekeying of office and exterior doors, and the South County Senior Center flooring repairs. Now, I'm sorry?
What'd you say?
The South County Senior Center flooring upgrade, re-carpeting,
You said repairs, but...
Repairs. Sorry, replacement. Yeah. Now, the two issues, I think, from when we talked about this, one, and Doug, I'm sorry, I asked you, I think you printed out the response.
I did, and I haven't read it. The question was that there was some discussion about the key rekeying of Town Hall.
Which way?
And there was some discussion about the creation of a use of a key card system and so on and so forth. And the real bottom line to that is that even if we went with a key card system, which is far more versatile and far more useful and far more flexible and probably slightly more secure, the downside is you still need to rekey Town Hall anyways.
Right.
So at that point, after realizing that, it was Kevin's best recommendation that we stick with recoring, rekeying the locks first. And then later on down the line, if we have the money and the wherewithal and we want to go with a card system, great. But for now, the recommendation is to recore all the locks. This is a higher request than you might get if you went and, you know, talked to Bob's locksmith someplace, or if you went and just bought new cores for all the door locks. But the keys in the locks themselves are, they're going to be a higher grade, a professional quality, by which you cannot just go to Abishan and make a copy.
Right.
As a matter of fact, you actually have to go to the place where the keys were initially cut, and you have to be on their master list in order to get a copy made. They'll be able to make a copy for any one of these locks at any time, but if you're not authorized to do so, you're not buying one. So there's that.
And so this does not contemplate any additional, I guess, security measures. I know motion detectors or things were kind of discussed.
There were a couple of things that were discussed in relation to securing. I'm sorry, that was from the, I think it's on here somewhere, isn't it not? The fire detection system upgrade.
Oh,
right. It's very likely that we're going to be able to do something along those lines to put in the silent alarm in the town clerk's office that they have requested. That will likely be a few hundred extra dollars more. And if it's something that we can't find somewhere else, then we'll come back to the finance committee to review that again.
Okay.
But we're pretty confident that these numbers are going to be able to carry us through.
Okay.
So.
All right. So then the one area that we did discuss had to do with the South County. I'm sorry. Sorry.
The key locks.
The keypad.
Yes. Yep. Oh, the keypad out there.
About security, I think I've run into two people that don't.
Yes, that is going to be changed.
That they do now.
And we're going to look into possibly replacing that with a keypad where there can be multiple codes, but that's still up in the air.
Right now, and it goes out email every year when they want it. When the books, people want it, they send it out, ask email how to get in the building and everything else.
Yeah, okay. That's cool.
The other thing I would like to recommend is, Dr. Lacey, is if you're considering a sign of call button, the assessor's office need there. They get some pretty high rate people in there as well.
Okay, I'll add that into the list and see what folks say. Yeah.
I know.
Been there.
Oh, yeah.
Okay. And on the senior center flooring, there were three sections of flooring that had been requested to be done. To remind everyone, I don't know if you have this information in front of you, the kitchen area, the lounge area, and the bingo hall. The Capital Improvements Committee had recommended just the bingo hall, the large area, and had wanted to hold off on the kitchen and lounge. I think it's fairly agreed that the large amount being done is the area that needs it the most for a number of reasons. I think there are some merits to the argument that having somebody come in to do all three in one shot saves you some money from having them come in three different times to do it over the course of a few years. How does anyone feel about this?
We already voted to do all three.
I don't think that we did.
We discussed it.
Then. We discussed them. I don't think we voted any capital items because they weren't part of any particular budget.
What were the numbers again, roughly?
Sorry. So the bingo hall area requested $7,000. The lounge area is $4,700. And the kitchen area is $2,200. So the amount the capital committee recommended was $7,000. The total amount would be $13,900 to do all three areas.
I think we should follow what Capital Improvement says we should do.
I agree.
The
other two floors can be sealed with a heavy wax for the time being till they figure out what they're doing over
when
there?
When you figure out how to wax carpeting, you
well, no.
Be, no. The lounge area, the dining room is right. One of the rooms that will not be refinished, and that's carpet. And that was the reason for wanting to replace that.
Right.
We could wax it.
I'm with Doug that it's a little trickier, but I'm also with the people here that said that the Capitol Committee spent the time on
video
this.
Videotape it. That'll be great.
I'm inclined to agree with them on this one. So then that would leave us, oh man, we're going to have to add this up. Do we have to pass a number here, Doug? Or do we just say we approve of the, as suggested by the Capital Improvement Committee?
You can just vote to recommend the CIPC's, or vote to endorse CIPC's recommendation.
Yep. Oh, that's right here, actually. Yep. All right, so I'd make a motion then vote to vote to endorse, thank you, the Capital Improvement Committee amount, which totals $50,787 for all requested projects other than the kitchen and lounge areas of the senior center.
I second that.
Thank you. All those in favor?
Aye.
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 Aye. Okay. Now, the remaining four articles on the special town meeting warrant, I'll briefly summarize them. I just want to talk about all four as a group for a second. Article 5 has to do with changing the bylaws related to shift deferential pay. Article 6 is related to changing the bylaws, which speak to the manner in which sewer repairs and improvements and projects can be funded. Article 7 speaks to a change in zoning bylaws, and Article 8 speaks to general court enacting special legislation to extend the powers provided in Chapter 121C to its Economic Development Industrial Corporation to include commercial, business, and housing development projects, this being related, I believe, to the end of the DEDIC process, as we talked about before. I wanted to bring up all these together because all four of them are things that I think all of us will have opinions on as individuals and taxpayers and townspeople, and even during town meeting as finance committee members, to stand up and speak to or against, but I'm not sure that they're things that I see the finance committee taking action on, having specific and dedicated financial budgetary ramifications that we can provide guidance on. And I wanted to see what other people on the committee felt about that in general, or any of these specifically, and Doug as well.
Well, Article 5, I don't see why we can't just vote it the way it is. It's saying pay shift a dollar raise or a buck and a half raise, and I wouldn't worry about it. I'd just turn around and rubber stamp that.
I don't think so.
And I hear you on that. I don't think there's anything particularly.
There's nothing difficult about it.
Well, we don't.
Right now they've got
we don't do
45 cents an hour.
And 60.
And they're going up to a buck. And a shift differential from 60 cents to a buck 50. That's not rocket science. That's just a general policy decision.
I agree with that, and I think it does have to do with the way that the town is handling this issue, which had a discrepancy between a couple of departments, and they're trying to resolve that discrepancy, and I do support them doing it, but we don't know what this does to any budget.
Exactly.
So that's where I mean, it seems like a good idea.
It's a policy
as an individual,
kind of thing,
I support them doing it, but that's kind of, and again, we've had this discussion before. We can recommend anything. We have the ability to do it. I've consistently taken a narrow approach of trying to do our job where we do our job and let the town do its job where it does its job.
The selectmen are requesting this, and I'd say we should rubber stamp this one.
Okay, specific to 5, anybody feel specifically about 6, 7, or 8 the same way or differently?
6 I'm opposed to.
6 I'm in favor of.
Okay. I'm opposed.
7 I think we should abstain from anything.
Okay.
Because we have no need to allow self-storage warehousing and worry about that. That's a town vote, so.
Okay.
7, I would say no action required. Article 8, I would say rubber stamp that one because I'm on DEDIC.
Anyone else on the zoning board so we can rubber stamp that one for them?
Planning board should be doing.
All right, well, I am open. We'll go through one by one. Anyone who'd like to make a motion, you're free to do it. I'll be abstaining from any votes. I've made my position clear, but I understand this is a committee. And
motion to approve Article 5.
All right. So I have a second.
I'll second that.
All right, thank you. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Anyone else?
I'm going to abstain because I don't know how it's going to affect budgets.
Okay, so let's say, so two yeses, any noes?
I'm abstaining.
Okay, any abstentions? Is it four abstentions?
Yep.
Okay.
So the two positives carry out.
I guess so.
Yeah,
I
don't
know. No. Unfortunately, they do
does
not.
Does it make a difference if I can tell you how much it's going to affect any budget?
No.
It's the only budget it's going to affect is South County EMS.
Sure.
It adds up to about $40 a day, which would add overall about $14,000 to their bottom line.
But the police...
I'm sorry, but back out of that, because they're currently paying the 60 cent or 40 cent and 45 cent and 60 cent,
right.
Whatever it is.
Okay.
So it's actually only going to add about $7,000 to their bottom line.
But the police department has the same thing.
They currently pay that. It won't affect their budget whatsoever.
They pay what?
They pay the
dollar. They pay a dollar and a dollar 50.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
That's necessitated.
It kind of levels out the policy. And
okay, so that vote did not carry. Bruce has a comment.
Yet there is a piece in there on that.
I guess my question is when a department, when the normal work hour in this town is say 8 to 5 or 8 to 4:30 or 9 to 4, mm-hmm. if somebody is doing flex hours and mm-hmm. the department is working 6 to 2, that's outside the defined work day.
Yeah, that's a question I have too.
And Doug, I think you can speak to that because we talked about it before.
The origin of this requested change comes from the fact that the way Chapter 35, Section 23 was written is that it relied on whether the individual was regularly scheduled for second or third shift work. And the question came up, well, okay, what about a per diem person? Are they ever regularly scheduled for anything? And when we asked around, we talked to the EMS director who said, no, we don't pay shift differential for per diems. But we talked to the police chief who said, yes, I pay shift differential for every person who works a second or a third shift. And so then in my mind, the question was not whether the person earned the money, whether it made sense to pay a shift differential, but how people were being, you know, treated. Because you could have two guys on the EMS staff overnight. One of them was making 65 cents more an hour than the other just by virtue of the fact that he was working full time. So the language, for the most part, is designed to put the onus on the department. Does the department regularly schedule people for a second shift or a third shift, basically more than 4 days a week, more than 9 months out of the year? Doesn't 2 to 10
in the morning. Because you've got hours on here.
Who's gonna
follow well, mission, you know, one of the departments that normally schedules 6 a.m. to 2.
It wouldn't affect them.
It wouldn't?
Wouldn't affect them. 6 a.m. to 2 p.m. wouldn't affect them. That's a first shift.
But this one goes till 7 a.m.
Right.
So why wouldn't that affect them also?
They just scheduled it to be standard 8-hour shifts, period. It slides an hour or something, no big deal.
But if it is an 8-hour shift, even if you work in the police department, you work third shift, you get a dollar and a half.
Yeah.
What I'm saying is the highway department starts at 6. And you've got times in here.
Okay.
Right.
Yeah.
I didn't change the times. The times were exactly as they were.
I know, but I'm
so
just saying.
So if we're holding true to the fact that someone who works from 6 a.m. to 2 p.m. should be paid an hour of shift differential,
mm-hmm.
then you owe a crap load of money to the highway guys.
I know that. That's what I'm saying.
This is why.
Could we rewrite red light the whole thing?
It'll be brought up if you do that.
So it says first shift, second shift, third shift, sure. But the intention was that it's covering guys who are normally, or folks who are normally scheduled for that. Second shift, third shift. That's the expectation.
Their regular shift, I guess.
But you put in, but you put in hours.
Is actually working an hour
in. Yeah.
Right.
Right.
Yeah. But it's not about the person. It's about the department. Does the department schedule people from 11 p.m. to 7 a.m. regularly? The answer is no. then they don't pay shift differential.
But if they work even an hour into the third shift on...
They're not regularly not scheduled.
Regular
schedule.
It's not the regular schedule.
To 7 a.m.
Right.
Regularly.
Right.
In this case, regularly shall mean no less than four times a week and no less than 36 weeks per fiscal year.
But then they would be doing that because that's how they do it every day of the week, every week of the
but
year.
But not from 11 p.m. to 7 a.m. It's got to meet both times. It can't just fall within that.
Okay.
Because otherwise you'd have to pay second shift differential for 1 hour for everyone who works in town hall.
Right. And so, again, this did not carry, and this is, again, why I feel that we don't have
there's
the capability at this point to opine on this, as this information has not been presented to us and I think should be talked about at town meeting, and be happy to articulate that that's part of why we did vote to abstain, or some of us did.
Sure.
Okay, Article 6. Would somebody like to have us recommend or not recommend this? Or would you like to?
I'd recommend it only because I think it's important that we, the selectmen, want to do this so that they can apply for different type of grants and different funding sources. And I think it's necessary to do that. The difference between straight users of personal septic systems, that's something that's going to have to be worked out, and it's going to have to be worked out later. It can't be worked out now because you got to wait and see what the project's going to cost. And there are a lot of businesses in this town that came to this town because of the sewers. If they didn't have sewers, we wouldn't have half the business in town. And since business contributes $2 to $2.5 million a year out of our $10 million income that we get from taxes, then we should be able to use part of that. For a year, all the people on septic systems were using that for their personal benefit. Now it's time that we use some of that money, and people just step up and pay whatever they have to pay.
I think that everybody, I think most people kind of know which side of the fence they sit on this one.
Yeah,
I think
I'd
those
like
are very good points.
Either you have a septic system or you don't.
That is a lot of how it goes. I think the question here is more, would we like to, as a committee, vote on this or not? So anyone who would like to can make a motion to do it. I'll again be abstaining. As an individual, I have a strong opinion on this, and I'm happy to speak to it at town meeting. But again, as this is not directly related to a budget, and we don't even know what budget ramifications this would have on enacting it or not. Although
why
we could
don't we abstain from this one?
Right, because I'd like to have an opportunity to discuss this too. And as far as I'm concerned, it's premature. It's premature to ask people to vote on this article to change a bylaw that we don't know the impact of. Now we say it's going to be after the fact. If they vote to change the bylaw where everybody can be charged, right now we have no idea what the cost of the project's going to be. We have no idea what that charge is. So you're asking the non-users to vote their right away by changing this bylaw before they know the impact of what it's going to be on their tax rate. And I'm not arguing the fact that there's value as far as business and so on and so forth, but I think it's premature. I have like 16 items here that I could address why I think it's premature. And we have voted to do a sewer study, and I would recommend that we wait till we get that sewer study back before we talk about changing bylaws of what and how who we can charge. And one big question that I have is, does the added value of extending the sewer line justify the cost? We don't even know if extending the sewer line is going to justify the cost of extending that. And also, we have two treatment plants. We don't know if one's coming offline. We don't know if both are coming offline. We don't know if we're keeping both of them. And the question comes down to is, instead of extending a sewer line, why can't we just upgrade the two plants that we have existing now to meet the state standards, the requirements, and go with that cost? Right. And then at that point, we can vote.
Excuse me. I think unless anybody strongly feels that we should be voting to recommend or not this item, it seems like most people are fine taking no action. And then I'd like to move on.
I think so.
Okay. All right. 7, the zoning bylaw. Does anyone feel strongly about taking action on that one? I do not. Anyone?
You shouldn't do it because it's zoning.
Right.
Yeah.
And I feel similarly about Article 8.
Not our game.
having to do with DEDIC and their process, which they are, it's going to be great to hear whoever it is stand up and speak to it and articulate to the town what this is.
You want me to explain to you what it is very simply?
Not right now. We got a lot of stuff to do.
So we're taking no action?
I would like to take no action. If someone would like to make a motion, I'm not going to stop someone from doing so.
Not worth it.
Okay. All right, so that is special town meeting. We've gone through all the warrant items.
Article 5, you did not recommend. Article 4, you...
We recommended the CIPC.
Yep.
3, we had the 100,000 from stabilization, balance from free cash.
2 for the year 2000.
2, we recommend.
That's been changed.
2, we held off to confirm the numbers. Mm-hmm. And 1, we...
Took no action.
We took no action on 1 as well, right? Because we're going to come back.
2, you held off because you...
At the year 2016.
Well, you were... But no, we were going to verify... That if was this was the 17 number used for 16 or the 16 calculated number that's also being used for 17, we can vote Article 2 next week once we have that information.
And I'm sorry, Article 1 may be passed over, so
We passed over 1, yes. Yeah. So passed over 1, passed over 2, but returning to it. Passed 3 with the adjustment to stabilization.
Yep. Recommended.
Passed 4 with CIPC recommendations.
Yep.
Did and not then, pass 5.
Yep.
And took no action on 6, 7, or 8.
Okay.
All right. We have a number of regular town meeting warrants. I don't think we're going to get through all of them tonight, so I will try to do the ones that I think will be most relevant for people to hear our opinions or thoughts in anticipation of the public presentation of the budget tomorrow. First question I have is on Article 10. Doug, it seems to me that this is seeking to raise appropriate borrow transfer from available funds, money for the Headworks project. I thought that this year's contemplated budget just included the engineering for the Headworks project.
The $130,000 is for the engineering to be moved from retained sewer receipts.
Right.
Sewer retained reserves. Earnings, whatever we call it. Anyway, sewer reserve. Thank you. And that is one motion that is plugged in there. The second motion, which I only started drafting today, it has not been passed council by any stretch, was a motion to essentially, and I'll summarize, to borrow a certain sum for the construction, upgrade, and repair of certain facilities and equipment at the South Deerfield Wastewater Treatment Facility. That amount of money will likely be about $2.7, $2.8, $2.9 million. Okay? That includes more than just the grit removal system that were the solids removal system that was originally discussed. It's actually solids removal, grit removal. It includes a facility to hold a generator, includes a new generator to replace the Korean War era generator that's there, which won't run the plant.
Okay.
It includes a number of different things.
Right.
Let me finish out the motion. Said sum to be expended under the direction of the Deerfield Board of Sewer Commissioners. And to meet said appropriation, the Board of Selectmen and Town Treasurer are authorized to borrow. Further, that any project costs incurred in excess of any grant approved by and received from any state or federal agency shall be the sole responsibility of the sewer rate payers of the town of Deerfield, and that the amount of borrowing authorized shall be reduced by any grant amount received by the town. That's, again, my bad, non-verified, fake legalese.
Are you going to be looking for us to make, well, first of all, being that both of these items are contemplated to be paid by sewer users specifically, does the Finance Committee even have an opinion on this, being town? And I understand it's kind of weird because then the town is going to vote on these things.
A Finance Committee has the right to speak on any article, on any motion, on any warrant.
I agree with that. And these do have a budgetary, these are of a budgetary nature, so I understand that, you know, they will have
an impact on the sewer ratepayers.
Right.
Yep.
And would you be looking for two separate recommendations, one for the engineering and the other for the project itself?
Yes.
Okay. Well, then I'll start by, I would make a motion that we recommend the $130,000 for the engineering project, which is something we've discussed before and all of us did think was vital first step towards whatever it is we end up doing.
Well, we already voted that before.
We did.
I think we did.
I didn't know if we need to do it now that it's actually Article 10 versus
If we did it before for a town meeting, why do we do it again?
Because you may be exactly right, and I may have confused something. Right. Please give me a moment to take a quick look, if you
would. From the sewer rate fund, that $130,000. And that was recommended by the Capital Improvement Committee.
It was already voted.
All right. If I remember correctly.
Mm-hmm. Please give me a moment. Because if that is the case, then that's 10.
No, we voted the sewer rate study for 10,000.
You voted the sewer rate study for 10,000 in January.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, that's it.
I don't believe we voted the one today.
I think you're right.
Yeah. Correct. No. 2.9 at special town meeting in January. Article 1 was 2.9 million for the school roof. Article 2 was 10,000 for the sewers rate study. Article 3 was to allow two police officers to work past age 65. And Article 4 was the to take all steps necessary to keep South County EMS in the town of Deerfield. And that was it. Four articles.
I second your motion.
Well, before you second, I'd like a little discussion because I do have a question with that.
Sure, we'll do the second and then open for discussion. So that's typically what we do. So,
who said? Did you, sir?
I meant on the 130, of
yes.
course.
Yeah. So this is just for the engineering, just for the 130, and Jeff has requested we hold for discussion, so we will.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. One quick question. Doug, you were saying sewer rate payers as far as the funding for this?
I'm saying the $130,000 comes from the retained earnings.
Sewer reserve.
Sewer reserve.
Right. And that's the only item we're discussing. We're not discussing those
0.7.
Right.
That's why I tried to clarify,
okay.
right. Jeff, to yep. say.
No, very good stop, okay. Jeff, and now that we're all on the same page.
Thank you.
Okay. All those in favor of the $130,000 being taken from sewer reserve to fund the engineering component of the Headworks project?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. All right, unanimous.
I don't know what Mary didn't say.
I think she said aye.
I did hear it.
to whatever standing we do have as a finance committee on this, on the large sewer project, even understanding that it's not, that it said it won't be funded from sewer users, I just have and that's not a project we've looked at the details. The last time I remember seeing it, I thought it was 1.5 million.
I thought it was 1.2 million.
Yeah.
When you were talking just the initial Headworks project, it was 1.2 million.
Right, and that's.
And then people started tagging on.
Sure.
And somebody said, well, we would want the opportunity to accept septage from outside vendors.
Sure.
And we wanted the opportunity to have a generator. And we wanted an opportunity to put in a grit collection system. And those things added up.
Okay.
At this point, in order to do everything efficiently, what's also in the mix is actually. Well, something else which I'll talk to you about off camera if you'd like. But anyway,
sure.
Just realizing that I really shouldn't talk about it on camera. So anyway, and that's where the price is higher. The numbers are not solid yet. They're still being talked about, which is why I don't have a number, a dollar amount in here. I have a meeting with Weston and Sampson on Thursday.
Well, I feel strongly that we can take no action due to lack of details, or mm-hmm. I'd be happy to vote against it because I don't approve of something with such little detail to it.
I think this is premature because we talked about 1.2 million. Now we're talking almost $3 million again.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
And everybody can say, well, add another truck into that and add something else into it. We don't need it.
Okay.
Especially when we're going to turn around and rip off the sewer users.
I know. I don't think you.
Which article are you talking about?
The request for $1.7 million.
Article 10.
The one that you're talking about for sewer use.
I think he was
article
reading
10.
The motion that would accompany that article. I believe, is that correct, Doug?
Article 10 to see if the town will vote to raise and appropriate, borrow, transfer from available funds or otherwise provide. Any sum or sums of money for the repair and upgrade of certain facilities and equipment at the South Deerfield Wastewater Treatment Facility, so-called Headworks Project, or take any action there too.
And so you're saying that the details of that article will be broken into the engineering for $130,000 and then the
Correct.
Larger project as described. So I think we are going to, we have recommended the 130 for engineering. We are taking no action on the other component of Article 10. So will it be read that way, Doug, when it's read that we, you know, recommend the engineering but took no action on the larger project?
Fair enough.
Okay. All right. Quick question, CPA projects. I feel like last year we did go through them, but I have not seen them yet.
I just received the information from Dan Graves. That's Article
13.
13, thank you. There's a total requests of $25,100 in CPA projects. I believe it's 25-1. Let me do the math. 5,100 and 20,000. Yeah, $25,100 in CPA projects. Both are requests made by the Historical Commission.
Okay.
Committee of the Town of Greenfield or Deerfield. And that's it.
All right, so we'll review those details over the next week and come back to that next week. I don't have any big picture problems with what they've done over the past couple of years, so we'll just take a look and go there. Doug, real quick, on Article 15, Smith Voke language, it says three students in the article. I don't know if we need to be specific, and I know that this year that I think is incorrect.
It is incorrect. It is likely one student. Total amount of $32,956.
Yeah, we voted those amounts. I just
yep.
noticed the language.
Yep.
Okay.
It is just carried over from last year. Yeah, and I didn't catch the word three.
That's just one student. Mm-hmm.
Oh, hey, there's another one. That should be a type. That should be 2016-2017. Yep. Yep. That'll be fixed in the article, in the motion.
All right. I'd like to go down to Article number 19, OPEB, one we've discussed before and had held off taking action. I
think the board did reduce their request to 10,000.
No, we didn't vote on it that way.
You guys didn't vote on it, but I think
no.
at the
no, we talked
the
about
they talked about it
last week.
Did they officially do that? They said that they were fine with doing a smaller amount.
Yeah,
yeah.
And I think they actually suggested 10,000.
Okay,
I'll quickly check to make sure that's the case. Yeah, it's at 10,000 right now.
That's what we recommended.
Make a motion. We change that from 10,000 to zero.
Okay. Is there a second?
Yes.
Okay. Would anyone like to have discussion before voting?
Yeah.
Okay.
My thoughts are, as we discussed last time at the meeting, is we don't know where this money's going. We don't know how they're going to spend it. And as long as we set up the fund and doing the studies, I don't think we're required to do anything right. else.
Right.
Well, Dylan had an opportunity Saturday to question the governor one-on-one on this.
Yeah.
He obviously doesn't know either.
Yeah, honestly, yeah. The governor's like, not sure.
Not
still
sure.
talking about it.
See me in a year.
And said what you're going to do is he's going to have a study commission look at it in a couple of years.
Yeah.
So there's no sense jumping on it prematurely. One of the strategies that can be articulated is that once we get to 2028 or 2033 when we finish Frank County retirement upgrading, then at that point we can look at OPEB funding.
Right.
So it's not like we got to do it right now. We don't need to do it now. Put in $0
right.
and we're all set.
Right. And Doug, if the official request was revised to 10,000, then those free cash numbers at a minimum we talked about earlier would go up by 40,000.
No, those free cash numbers are up to date, taking into account that $10,000 request. If you drop from 10,000 to zero, then.
No, but if it. Because the one that had the 268 from last week had 50 from OPEB. So
we'll have to go through the numbers and look at them again then.
Something else changed then.
Well, that should drop 50. We should add 50,000 of free cash.
Well, it should add 40 if they revise their request. If it went actually carried through at zero, it would add another 10.
Right.
Yeah.
So that's 50,000.
Well,
yes.
If it went 50
but
to 10.
But we're saying if
I'm just taking a shortcut. I don't want to talk all night.
I understand. I
just want to say if it started at 50 and we go to zero, that's 50,000.
Okay, I will cease filibustering. It's been made and seconded. Any other comments? All right, all those in favor of zero for OPEB for this year?
Aye.
Aye.
The next one I want to discuss is Article 20, the Montague Defense. So, as we discussed in the joint meeting last week, this is money the town of Deerfield would be paying to the town of Montague to aid in their legal costs related to a lawsuit that's being brought, and I don't know all the legal details, but I will say being brought against Berkshire Gas mm-hmm. and others potentially about the gas moratorium that was placed upon the area, and whether that was, in fact, should have been a moratorium, or whether it's related to pressures being put on the area to build the pipeline. So that is a lawsuit that the town of Deerfield has nothing directly to do with, but certainly is an issue that the town of Deerfield and other towns and areas care about.
To be very clear, it's not a suit, it's an action that is being undertaken through the Department of Public Utilities. It's a hearing to determine whether or not Berkshire Gas's moratorium on new connections and new business is actually justifiable. Montague is taking participation as an intervener. Many other communities are helping to support the work that they're doing. The end result, if they prove out, if they prevail in this, is that Berkshire Gas would probably be ordered by the DPU to open up for new connections. Mm-hmm. That would directly affect a significant number of homes and businesses in Deerfield. So people have asked, okay, so what do we get if we win? And the answer is, we get new gas connections.
Right.
We get them having to open up the gas line, which could make a significant difference between being able to further develop over the industrial park or being able to further develop on Route 5 and 10 versus not.
Right, and I think that the challenge for me with this, I do see the direct connection. To the extent that this was something that was being brought by FERCOG on behalf of the county, and whether requested or given the opportunity to contribute, I'd be more open to doing so. I am a little bit concerned about the town of Deerfield giving money directly to other towns bringing lawsuits where the people of Deerfield may or may not approve of them or disapprove of them. We're not sure how much it will or won't help. I guess that's my concern, is this direct funding from one town to the next, and really the genesis of the funding. I'm kind of curious how it came to be that the town of Deerfield is offering $10,000 to the town of Montague.
The only entity in Franklin County, including Steve Kulik, he was denied. Everyone was denied. The FERC was denied. The only one given intervener status in this was Montague. Mm-hmm. So they're the front men because of that.
And I guess I don't know the backstory as to why they didn't work through FERCOG to, and maybe they can. I don't know what the details are.
They applied and were denied status too.
Why FERCOG isn't helping the legal costs of Montague on behalf of the county. Right, I mean, we all pay to FERCOG for them to do.
Yeah, they don't get involved with individual lawsuits.
Well, should we? That's the question.
Good question. So that means we should take no action on this and talk about it on town meeting floor.
I agree.
I support that as well.
I agree with that. Yep. Concerned with
so,
the,
Doug, taking no action on Article 20.
Yeah.
Article 21 is the mosquito testing article. So now this would seek to fund, I believe it's $11,000, Doug? Is that the amount, mosquito testing?
I believe the amount is $11,000.
Yes. $11,000 to test mosquitoes in and around the town of Deerfield. To see what sort of communicable diseases they may carry, some of which are certainly harmful, and some of which have been found in mosquitoes in other towns in Western Mass. My feeling on this one is that there's going to be a number of testings done in a number of areas within Franklin and Hampshire counties, and I feel pretty strongly that whatever those mosquitoes have, ours are going to as well. So I have a tougher time. What's that?
Ours are cleaner.
Or cleaner. You know, even if we find, like, if we find nothing dangerous but something dangerous in Greenfield, we're still going to be concerned. So I don't know. That's my feeling. How do you guys feel about this one?
I mean, are they actually going to come into Deerfield and test them? Or?
They are. There would be a handful of locations. There would be, I believe, weekly tests over a period of I'm not sure how long. And the results would be sent to, I'm not sure exactly what lab. I think, you know, we're kind of feeling our way through the process a little bit. What had been looked into is to be part of it's not a mosquito district, but there's another name that's something like that. And the cost of that was fairly prohibitive. And so the select board, I believe, was sending a letter to the state saying that we're interested in having a mosquito district, but the cost is prohibitive. And what can we do to try to make this affordable to address a real concern? And that course, you know, depending on what the costs are, is something that I think it is interesting, but right now I don't know that the results of this test, regardless of what they are going to change our actions in the short term. And we are going to have the advantage of the information that comes back from other testings in the local area. And so given, you know, how much we've tried to hold the line on these budgets, this is one that I would not recommend personally.
This thing from the Cooperative Public Health Service through the COG. Town residents received 35 free tick tests in 2015 through a district grant, a saving of $1,750. 30% of the ticks tested in Deerfield carried the Lyme pathogen. An additional 6% tested positive for either anaplasmosis or barbiceus. Staff provided tick prevention materials and helped residents access grant funding, tick testing as needed.
But we already
know
the
COG did. And we got 30% that have the
They estimate
Lyme
this year,
pathogen.
Yeah, they estimate this year over 30% of the ticks will have Lyme in New England because of the mild winter.
Yes, Bruce.
That's cool.
I've been to a couple of selectmen's meetings, and there seems to be so much crossover between whether this is for testing, abatement, or district use. Mm-hmm.
We initially did hold off because there was some confusion between Doug and I a couple weeks ago at our meeting as to what this was for. When we had our joint meeting last week, we asked and was clarified that this money is for the testing, that there was a letter being sent to handle the district, and that there's no abatement currently contemplated in either of those paths, although either of them could lead to future projects and funding that include abatement. Testing. That's what. Right. There's some money in, I believe, the Board of Health budget for some abatement activities. Doug, correct me if I'm wrong, we put something in the culverts?
About $1,500. Basically, it buys those little spiral things that chlorinates our drainage culverts.
Right.
They get dropped in a couple
so
times a year.
So that is the only abatement thing that I know, and it was done last year and is being requested again for this year and is separate from this. This, to my knowledge, that we confirmed last week with the Select Board, is just for testing.
Because they've been doing that for some number of years in any standing water.
Yeah.
So why don't we take no action on this? Mm-hmm. Recommend no action.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Since you're on this page, do you want to cover the Franklin Regional Council of Government core assessment?
I do. You read my mind.
Article 14?
Yes, Article 14.
We didn't vote on that, did we?
We did not. We held off on this, and the reason I had stated at the time, I just wanted to look into and refamiliarize myself.
You're going to hold on this one?
On which one?
The mosquito?
We're going to hold on the mosquitoes. That's what
no
was
action.
Asked.
No action.
No action.
No action.
Unless you feel strongly?
No.
Okay. So we'll get some clarity, and we can speak to it at town meeting if we so choose. On the FERCOG assessment, I wanted to hold off at the time because in FY16, there was a fairly large reduction and then kind of an increase back up, and I just wanted to go refamiliarize myself with the history of this budget and kind of how some of those changes took place. Basically, there was a large shift in the pension liability structure within FERCOG, and that's what led to excess funds that led to the lower town assessments in FY16. The FY17 budget is a fairly marginal increase. The budget was up 1.7%, which left the Deerfield assessment up 2.2%, I think it was. So
they left county and went to state.
Exactly. Exactly. So given that, and then I also asked, just to give more, there's a handbook that has some kind of general services that are available to the towns, but a little more specifically, some of the things that have been done recently. And the feedback I got was that FERCOG has done a lot with the pipeline effort in terms of identifying different paths, courses, options, advice related to the pipeline conversation that the town of Deerfield is having with other local towns, state and national organizations as well. They also did a feasibility study on regionalizing the police force for the town of Deerfield. They also said that they helped with DEDIC and planning board with zoning bylaw updates. They also provided workshops for local municipal officials. And then, as I think came up in our highway conversation, they handle some of the RFPs for things like the gas and diesel purchases coming out of the highway department. So just to, as I'm sure everyone will ask, okay, what are we getting for 40 some odd thousand dollars? Those are some of the examples of things. And then there are more general services that they provide that we may not have used last year, but may this year. Anybody have anything to add or want to recommend a motion for, where is that amount?
One of those papers I gave you.
Yep. So let's see. The FERCOG assessment request is $43,701, which is a 2.22% increase in Deerfield's assessment, which, as I said, their budget is up 1.7, and through their formula, that's our.
I'll move.
I second it.
Thank you. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. All right. Unanimous. Okay. The next one I'd like to do.
What number was that?
That was 14.
That was 14.
Article 22.
22.
I don't have that one on my list, but let's see what we got.
Salaries of compensation of the elected officials.
Sure. Do we?
Let me read the recommended.
Yep.
Because essentially you approved everything except the select select board salaries. So the difference between the requested and recommended, it's only in the select board lines. Mm-hmm. You recommended moderator at 300, moderator for special town meeting 50. I think it was a total budget of 350. Assessor's chair 2500, assessor's associate members 2250. School committee chair 150, school committee associate members 100. Those are numbers you actually haven't voted, but you did somewhere, I think. And elector Oliver Smith Will $20. The select board chair, you recommended 2500, which is no change from last year. And the select board associate members, you recommended 2250, which is no change from last year.
Right.
So they changed.
We vote that?
Not as a collective for the article. If Doug, you know,
make a motion, we approve this article.
Thank you. Do I have a second?
Second.
Thank you. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. All right.
And that's how it'll be shown, is a requested column and a recommended.
Perfect. The next one I'd like to do is article number 11. This is the South County EMS. We've obviously discussed this budget a number of times and had a couple of people come in to speak with us and went to the public presentation as well. To whatever extent possible, although if there is a reason to do so, feel free. I'd like to stay away from line item conversation at this point, just because we've gone over a lot of the line items at this point. This really is about the bigger budget. I feel like it's primarily about a conversation of should they be using more retained earnings to offset the assessment or not. People feel differently, feel free to speak up to that end. But that was my take of the summary of our conversations to date, was it was kind of ready to discuss, okay, here's the budget, should more be used to offset, or is this an appropriate amount? I will start the conversation just by saying that I do think a lot more can and will be done with this budget in future years, but at this point, I do support this budget as requested.
I second that.
I was making a motion, but
I thought you were. You said
I was starting the conversation, but thank you. I'll leave it open for discussion.
Oh, okay.
But thank you, Ralph. Yeah. Would anyone else like to speak about this budget?
Yes. I want to say the budget is still too high.
Okay.
And I want to say that we should be asking them to reduce the budget more. And without getting into individual line items, although you really have to if you want to discuss this budget, because they have $51,000 that they save from 1 year for the ambulance, $51,000 for a second year for the ambulance, and now they want to spend $285,000 for a new ambulance.
Well, to me, if we give them the $51,000 for a new ambulance for the third year, they weren't scheduled to do it for another year. What's the rush that they need it now? They don't need it, they want it.
Quick question, sorry to interrupt. Doug, Article 11 is the capital and operating budget for South County EMS.
Correct.
Does this include the purchase of the ambulance?
Yes.
But that is not part of, I mean, their operating budget, obviously we have, their capital budget, they don't have a capital request. They have a proposal to purchase a capital item out of their retained earnings.
I can only say that I used the format for this article that slightly modified but brought over from the previous year, which lists the revenues, it lists the expenses, and it lists the appropriation from Deerfield. The revenues include details for medical service fees, estimated medical service fees, retained earnings, and then the assessments from the three towns. The expenses includes salaries and expenses, and then it includes capital expenditures or the capital purchase.
Okay.
And then it lists Deerfield's appropriation to be clear at the very bottom.
So sorry, John, please continue. I just want to make sure we knew exactly how this was written and that we were voting on. So thank you. Do you have a number in mind when you think about what you would be looking to recommend or what you would be more comfortable with, either on their operating budget?
Just happen to have one right here.
Okay.
First of all, they're going to give us indirect costs for fiscal year 16, $57,899. I would like to see them increase the indirect costs for fiscal year 15, the year before that, for the same amount, $57,899, and that would require a 90% vote because that's a previous year bill. And then the only other change that I've got would be to waylay that ambulance to fiscal year 18 when they were supposed to do it and make the ambulance budget $153,000 for this year, and that would reduce the operating offset from like $46,000 to $184,000. And that's it.
Okay. So basically, so that would be reducing the operating budget by around $100,000.
How
does the operating budget get reduced by $100,000?
He's saying by if they did not purchase the ambulance.
It doesn't reduce the operating budget at all. It
doesn't touch the operating budget.
It would increase the operating budget by $51,000.
If they didn't purchase the ambulance and use and put 100, and I'm articulating your position, but
yep.
Instead of purchasing the ambulance, if they put $151,000 into their reserve for a future ambulance purchase and used $100,000 of the money they're not spending there in the ambulance to further offset the operating budget by 100, that was where that $100,000 came from.
Give me a moment to do the math on this.
Sorry, thank you.
There's one other thing that I failed to mention, and that was that they wanted to have an operating reserve of 10%. I feel 5% is adequate. The reason for that is because the school runs a $10 million budget, and they only get a 5% operating loss, and no other town departments get that. We don't need to start generating extra revenue because there's already extra revenue in there, and I think it's time to keep that tighter. But with that included, by dropping the operating reserves to 50,000, it still knocks off the 184,000 that I mentioned.
What do other people think?
You said 151?
Well, there's 51 times 3 years.
Oh, okay.
So that's 153,000.
Okay.
And then we're dropping the 100,000 reserve to 50,000. And then we're adding, instead of paying for 1 year administrative fee, add for a second year administrative fee. And other than that, I figure there's plenty of money in there so they can spread it around however they want to.
Just a clarification, I do believe that talking about receiving back $57,000, we'd only be receiving back $28,000 because our portion is only about 52%. So the total would be about $57,000.
No, it's 57 because we've already paid it.
So since we've already paid our 52%, we're getting it back.
It would.
Yeah, that's true.
You're both kind of right. We would be receiving $57,000. That said, the money being used to pay that is money that Deerfield had put in.
We already paid it.
50% is sitting in retained earnings. So it's kind of,
it's not like future, where you're billing for future services. This is for services you've already paid for.
Right.
Yep.
So we would get that back plus the other two towns' portion.
Mm-hmm. Does anyone else on the committee have?
So to be very clear,
yes.
57 would come back for FY15. 57 would come back for FY16. 57 would come to Deerfield in FY17.
Right.
You'd be using $132,000 for retained earnings to offset the operating expenses. You would not be buying the ambulance. Let me make sure I don't have the ambulance in here.
Well, you would have $153,000 in there for
us. He's going to tell us
for 3 years.
He's going to tell us what's
right.
Left.
No, I'm just getting. I've got that set aside.
I do believe 5% for reserve is a good move.
Yep. Assuming $57,000 comes back to the town for each of the 3 years.
Oh, no, you only get 2 years.
Plus the third year.
Oh, but that's in the budget.
Year.
Fair enough.
That doesn't come out of retained earnings.
Okay. Deerfield's assessment, regardless of the $57,000 coming back, Deerfield's assessment for FY17 would be $277,077.
And by your estimation,
you're bringing back $180,000. So you're going to pay $90,000 for your ambulance service.
How are we bringing back money?
You're doing it because
FY15, FY16, FY17.
But the 17 is part of the operation budget.
Okay, so you'd be bringing back $125,000,
right?
And you'd be paying about $115,000 for your ambulance service.
Okay, and with those, assuming those calculations. What sort of retained earnings?
That leaves $153,000. Oh, I'm sorry, but you want to
plus $50,000 in reserves. So that's
$182,000.
Okay, so it's around $190,000, assuming you're billed for FY16, billed for FY15, and $135,000 total was used to offset. But
offset the budget?
Offset
budget?
The operational budget.
I'm now at $182,000 of retained earnings being used to offset the FY17 budget.
182 is your number being
182.
Used?
182.
Okay. And that resulted in the
Deerfield assessment of 251.
251. And that resulted in a remaining retained earnings of
basically about 203.
203.
200, let's just call it. All right.
That would be the balance.
And you're 2 years away from buying an ambulance.
One point is, I do think that if people agree that the original schedule is to buy the ambulance next year, and assuming we just have $50,000 going in next year to do it, they'd need to be closer to 200 now. So I do agree that the set aside for the ambulance, even if it's going to be bought next year, needs to be a little bit higher.
Actually, you would really need to set aside the $51,000 for an ambulance in FY17. Remember that when they expected to spend the $300,000 on the ambulance, they didn't set aside any capital in their operating budget.
Right. So
adding that back in, and now you're back at 132.
No, you got 51,000 times 3 years. You got a total of 153. So that is already added in there because not taking out of the retained earnings.
You're right.
Right.
And you're still 2 years away from buying an ambulance.
So the question is, if they were going to be buying one next year, they would have to set aside an additional 50 so that they were 1 year away of purchasing the ambulance, if that is their original schedule. I think the other part that comes to mind here for me is, it is the difficult part about cutting it down this much is, how do you handle if it has to bounce back up? It's sort of like, to me, like gas budgets that we see in a number of things. We know gas has dropped. If you cut them all in half, I wonder if that's too aggressive moving towards where you are one step at a time. I take a little bit more of an iterative approach of, if something moves, you move towards it, not on it. And that's my concern, I guess, here with moving that much. I think that they have made an effort to move towards where we want to get to, which is using some of this retained earnings towards articulating their staffing plans, towards articulating their ambulance replacement schedule. And that's where I think everybody's in agreement of they need to be moving towards a goal. And the real discrepancy here is how much do they move this year towards that goal? What does anybody else on the committee feel about this matter?
I agree that I don't want to see it cut that low. 5% of the total is a good number to leave in retained earnings, I would think. What would that be, 5%?
I mean, I think on a more mature and stable department, I'd feel more comfortable with 5%. That's where, for me, that's a little bit tougher to get on it when they still have staff coming online. I do recognize that.
I don't disagree on the 5%. I think that makes sense.
Okay.
Allowing that much, $50,000, to go from one year to the next. That's my personal opinion, though. I can't, you know, there we are.
Right.
I would stand up and encourage the Board of Selectmen endorse that and to agree with that. But
so now, to the extent that we go, so let's look at it this way then. Let's assume that we've talked about the ambulance this year and next. We went through the math if they don't buy it this year. If they do buy it this year,
won't have the cash to do unless they take it right their budget for this year or this next year. And of course, you don't know what the retained earnings is going to be for this coming year when they get it in September.
Right, and I think that
the problem is that they can't spend whatever they've got. And that number will probably be higher because they're already going to have $203,000 built into it.
I think that their free cash, if you want to call it that, as retained earnings, will jump, just like the town of Deerfield does, because they'll have revenues that they estimated conservatively. We don't know how reasonably conservatively, but conservatively, and expenses that they're not going to fully utilize in every line item. So I think we can agree that it likely will go up rather than not. And, you know, it's not totally dissimilar to the conversation we had about our own free cash, where we were originally at $300,000 because that's still a number and we know it's going to jump, but then we also felt we want to move it back up. That was a little bit too close to the fire. So I think we're having a similar conversation here about how close do we want to get it. And layered on top of that is the conversation about the ambulance, replacing the ambulance this year versus next, because that really changes the numbers a lot. So could I take, sorry, Bruce has a question.
Well, one of the things that's incorporated in here for long-term capital planning is a rotation of three ambulances.
Mm-hmm. Just two. Just two.
Hold on.
I understand I'm not belittling the service. I totally support it. However, the expense of the town is going to be two and only two ambulances, in which case now you've thrown in a third one, which over the period of time is going to throw in approximately $300,000 plus your annual expenses and everything else on top of that, which is going to take away from the replacement schedule of the two. Somewhere along the line, you're going to end up doubling up again because of that third.
Well,
it needs to be, Board of Selectmen did not instruct the Board of Oversight to carry through with the wishes of the town's people, and now we have this $300,000, 2001. They should have never even been incorporated in the system. It's now become part and parcel of the annual capital expenditures.
Right, and the one comment I'd make before turning it over, just on that specific, and then you can continue if you have other comments, is after looking at this a number of times, I actually don't think that two or three ambulances changes their capital replacement schedule. I think in either case, they're buying a new ambulance every 5 years.
Yeah.
The difference is if you're going to have a fleet of two, that you replace the old one when it gets to 10 years, or you have a fleet of three where you place the old one when it gets to 15 years. In both cases, you're purchasing a new ambulance every 5 years. Now, there are perhaps other costs associated with them, some small, maybe just some inspections and things like that. Others may be large, how much they're going to staff second and third ambulances that can expand costs. And that's where we sought and did get some clarity on that this year, I'd say. And that's what kind of got me comfortable personally with their plan to replace this ambulance, even though it's different than their original schedule, and even though it is fortuitous in some sense for them to solve the problem of the retained earnings number that they have. I acknowledge both of those things, but I still think that with the ambulance Three ambulances of, I believe it's 8, 12, and 16. Are those the ages?
Something like that.
8, right. Something, and 16. I think the middle one's 12. I think the case to have a frontline ambulance that's new, a backup ambulance that's going to be 9 years old, and then your third ambulance that's going to be 13 years old is not crazy to me. Right.
So we have two ambulances to pick up 5% of calls.
Right. And that, I agree. And that's the question of, you know, if the third line ambulance to me is primarily just a backup if one of the first two breaks down, or something they can send out to the football game or the job fair or this whatever, not for emergency response, but just to be at things that they'd like that presence. Right, but either way, you're Right, but either way,
They should be trading in the one that's stationed at Sunderland is the frontline one.
Okay.
And putting this one stationed in Deerfield is the one in Sunderland.
And keeping the 17-year-old one?
No, that's Wheatley's.
Because that's only a backup to the backup.
I'd still like the backup to the backup to start, but let's hear from anyone else on the committee on this as. I think three of us have kind of gone around.
I'm leaning towards John's train of thought. I just feel there seems to be a little excess in free cash. And I think John's numbers are pretty close to what he's expressed. So I'm kind of leaning towards that way right now. I'd like to see that free cash. I agree with the 5%. And I'd like to see that free cash reduced a little bit more.
How do you feel about the replacement of the new ambulance? And I ask because obviously that's an important, I think we kind of have to answer that one first and then solve for what free cash we want, because if they do it or not, it changes the numbers.
Mm-hmm. Well, I haven't heard any major concerns about the frontline ambulance at the moment.
Or tomorrow.
Or right, or the backup, the third one, understandably, but putting it off a year, I don't think that would be a major issue. That's what I'm thinking at the moment. I could be wrong about that, but I'm just not seeing it.
Okay.
So the money that they were going to put in, take out of retained earnings, the $285,000, mm-hmm. won't go there, won't come out, but money towards the budget, operating budget, would. But you still have to put money aside.
They still have to put money in the capital for a replacement. They can't skip that for the following year.
I mean, we're still going to be needing to put aside. Mm-hmm. Well, that's the thing is, and Doug, maybe you'd have an answer to this. If they didn't buy the ambulance this year, how much money would they be putting aside on behalf of capital? Because it would have to be $200,000 for the ambulance if you're going to buy it next year, with a $50,000 from next year's budget, and whatever medical equipment, which is their other capital line item that you want to set aside from that as well. Mm-hmm. So that number is probably going to be $250,000 or more dollars.
They got budgeted $245,000 for the ambulance and $40,000 for medical equipment.
Right,
and that's specific to the medical equipment for the ambulance, but then there's other replacing medical equipment, so it's probably going to be even higher. So to me, if we go down the path of them not buying it, and I can't speak for them, but it would seem to me they'll be putting aside $275,000 to $300,000 for the preparation of ambulance purchase next year, as well as the other capital item requests that they've had each year and not wanting to have those be zero. As well, and the $40,000 for the medical equipment needed for the new ambulance when you buy it. So I guess my concern is I'm just not sure how much money we're freeing up by going down that route.
There's going to be a commitment every year from us for ambulance fund, and it's going to be pretty steady if they're turning them over every 5 years.
Well, and look, my other concern is there's no capital request in this year's budget. Next year there's going to be.
Right.
Whether they buy an ambulance or not next year, there's going to be. So that's part of, it's sort of a, maybe it's a relative comfort with the FY17 budget, just because I'm really concerned about what the FY18 budget's going to look like.
Assuming keeping $153,000 for the ambulance, assuming keeping $50,000 for other capital expenses, and those would have to both be, the $50,000 for the other capital expenses would have to be appropriated as such to allow them to spend it. Mm-hmm. The $153,000 held in retained, it's going to be held in retained earnings until we can actually establish a capital mm-hmm. stabilization. Assuming that you're holding back $203,000, assuming you're only allowing them to carry over $50,000 of retained earnings instead of the $100,000, then that brings up the total additional amount that you could apply to the budget to about $82,000, which would be, which would bring it up to about $142,000 in retained earnings, lowering the cost to the member towns to $525,299, and Deerfield's assessment to $271,000, $272,000, rough numbers.
Okay. So we're talking about recommending a Deerfield assessment of either as requested 314, 307, or Doug, may I use round numbers, or would you like to give me an exact one for that other calculation? 272,000 even, is that close enough?
271,901.
Okay. So we've identified the range that we're talking about here in terms of the Deerfield assessment for this year. 314, 307 on the high end as requested, 271,901 on the low end as calculated going through the framework we just went through. I'll reiterate my position. I feel comfortable with the 314. I know that is not a small amount of money, but I have concerns about what they're going to be able to do going forward. And I also have been convinced, I think, that them purchasing the ambulance this year is in the best long-term interest of the service, despite it not being a easy decision. That is kind of how I feel about it. And, you know, I don't think there's a ton more discussion. If someone who hasn't spoken, like Ralph, recently would like to jump in, please do. But otherwise, I think I'd like to vector towards someone making a, suggesting one of these two amounts.
My only comment would be that I know that a lot of people have worked very hard, thought a lot about this. There's a lot of real heartfelt seriousness in it. But I think I'm just hanging back to say this was an enterprise fund. It's a three-year thing, and I think I'm just holding them accountable to build it up the way they were outlined to do it and just fund it for that three-year period. At that point, then I think there's got to be some hard and serious discussions like you're having with them to hold them accountable. But I just don't feel I'm smart enough to understand all of what they're trying to do and what they've been charged to do. I only go back to what we agreed to at the original vote for this, and so I'm kind of hanging out there for that enterprise fund. But I agree with what you've said, Dylan.
And, you know, for me, I think if they were able to stabilize the ongoing costs of the service around $300,000 to the town of Deerfield, I think that's pretty decent service for that amount. You know, when it was up to 400 last year, closer to 400 and maybe going up and we don't know, and not a lot of answers on the budget, it was much more concerning. As you get down towards, you know, low 300s, and again, next year with the opportunity to maybe sharpen the pencil again,
right,
and get down,
right,
into the high 200s, mm-hmm, all of a sudden it seems like we're getting pretty decent service.
And that point I asked of lost his name, Selectman.
Mark.
I'm sorry. When I asked him, well, to the best of your memory, what was it way back when Deerfield just did it all by itself? And like you pointed out, it's not the same service at all.
Not even close.
Yeah, not even close. And I remember he said something like 179, but then he caught himself and he said, well, there was another 25,000 of capital. So I said, okay, well, a couple hundred thousand. He says, yeah, he says a couple hundred thousand. So you go back 3 or 4 years ago, $200,000 for a smaller service, and it's $314 this year for just about everything. When you factor in inflation also and the wicked improvement of the service, and of course this would not happen if we didn't have Sunderland and Whateley's contribution, But I still respect what John is pointing out, you know, tight management of the money and looking at things. But I just, again, not to repeat myself, I just think we give them the 3 years to measure it all out. And I think, you know, it's, we all agree they're doing, the service is good.
Well, we're basically talking about $44,000 difference between the two figures, correct?
Yeah.
Roughly, yeah. But we don't know what's going to happen next year because they're going to have the ambulance.
Right.
And the ambulance they're going to replace is 8 years old already, and they're talking about replacing them every 5 years.
Mm-hmm.
Well, next year I would anticipate their capital requests will increase. And so the hope would be that we could either use retained earnings and or reduce operational budget where you could to try to get back into this same area. Not, you know, if next year bounces up to 390,
yeah, then
they got a problem.
We got a problem.
I unfortunately won't be here to handle that budget process. But
you have Sunderland's version on
yes,
that one.
I will be handling Sunderland's. Probably not handling, but watching Sunderland's version. I think that would be challenging for everybody. All right, well, as I just now remembered, I actually, I guess, made a motion that was seconded way back at the beginning.
314.
For the 314-307.
Right.
They certainly have met us part way from when we started chatting with them. I mean, they're getting a little, especially around the staffing issue. I appreciate that they're coming around on that.
It's a whole new venture, completely different from what anybody imagined.
I guess I'm looking at for $44,000 for the third year that they're asking for, and you know, again, the check and balance system for next year's budget, as Dylan pointed out, if that's way up there, then obviously there's an issue. But if it's being able to maintain around the 300 or below that, so.
Remember that when the EMS budget first got built, I don't know if it was presented to this committee or not, but when the EMS budget for FY17 was first put forward, it was at $387,990. It included $50,000 for an ambulance. It included no use of retained earnings to balance its budget. That between Zach and myself, we looked at his budget, we looked at what we could reduce, we looked at the retained earnings that he was bringing over. He was not expecting to buy an ambulance this year, fair enough. But he was also not expecting to do anything with his monies. He said, oh, well, that money is pocketed away. It's capital reserve, and I can't touch that. And I said, in fact, you can, because it hasn't been reserved. It's just sitting there. It's retained earnings. Legally, we can use every dollar of that if we want. And so that started the conversation to talk about how we can leverage those retained earnings to advantage. And that's where we came up with the use of $60,000 plus for offsetting the expense of the budget. We talked about the buying of the ambulance, and we talked about still keeping about $100,000 in reserves to carry over to next year. That being said, at the time I thought $100,000 was high as well, but we went with it. The concerns that the Board of Oversight had was that they weren't holding on to enough, that they weren't sure about the expenses, that they weren't sure about whether or not it was enough to carry over. They were concerned about spending all of their retained earnings on the ambulance in that year, a year ahead of schedule. They anticipated that kind of bucking of pushing the schedule forward by 1 year. Zach and I made the case that the purchase of the ambulance made sense given the age of the current vehicles that they're using, the fact that they've only got one that is within the 10-year lifespan that they prefer to have an ambulance at, and the fact that we were using $60,000 of the retained earnings to bring the budget down to $315,000. One of the things, I think it was Tom Feidenkiewicz who raised the issue, he said, you can't use too much of the retained earnings to bring the budget assessment down because that's a one-time hit. It's a one-time reduction in the expense, and we may not be able to replicate it next year. I'm confident that we will be able to, between use of some retained earnings and reduction in tightening down of the belt, if you will,
and
that
increase,
we will be able to use
increase
in
revenue
that.
Estimates as well.
And there will be an increased revenue estimate. We'll have 3 solid years of revenues under the belt of the EMS, and I think that $410,000 that's currently there will probably go up to about $440,000.
Probably not much more than that. I think that's going to be a safe number. Next year, I think the budget will likely be about the same, and we will still have put away another $50,000 for an ambulance replacement starting on a new five-year retention schedule. If we cut the budget too low, then you get an artificial drop at town meeting floor that's going to just go back up the next year, and people are going to argue, why is this this high? You were down there before. Why can't you keep it there? There. Said what I need to.
All right. Well,
thanks.
As a lot of time has passed since I originally spoke, and it was originally a second, I'll withdraw my initial motion just so we can restart the clock here, and I will remake the motion to recommend the 314-307 for South County EMS. So that, as well as, are we recommending the purchase of the ambulance, or, sorry, Doug, I don't know how to speak to the article.
There are two things that the article will, that town meeting needs to do with the article. One is to approve the budget, and the other is to approve the town of Deerfield's assessment. But what will likely happen is that the budget will, the town meeting will vote to approve the budget as presented.
Okay.
Which lists out Deerfield's assessment in it.
Okay. So then I will make a recommendation, or I'll make a motion to recommend the budget as presented for South County EMS. Anyone like to second that?
I'll second that.
Thank you, Ralph. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. How many ayes? Hold up your hand. 1, 2, 3, 4. Opposed? 1, 2. All right, so it passes 4-2.
4-2? There's two opposed?
Yeah.
Okay. Sorry.
Yeah.
Okay.
He's not getting skipped that.
Right. Down to 6. Well, thank you guys for that one. I know that's a tough one. I know we're going to be speaking about it a lot at town meeting. Like, a lot of these recommendations don't mean that's how it'll vote, and that's part of the process. That is all the substantive stuff. Doug, are there any others? Actually, I have a quick question. There was one on reauthorizing all revolving funds. Were there any revolving funds you were looking not to reauthorize this year? I know we talked about this.
Plumbing, gas, and electric.
Okay, and what about the war bonds?
War bonds? That's not a revolving fund. That's simply an account.
Special revenue account.
I would love to take that money and put it back into the general fund. I don't know how.
Okay.
That's
for Conway and Deerfield, so I don't think you can. I'm not sure how you even take it out.
It was like war bonds slash town forest or something like that.
Yeah.
Okay.
I think that's going to take more research, and you have time left before town meeting.
How much money is involved in that?
$17,000 or something.
Yeah, it's not insubstantial, but I think you'll pay that much just to do the research.
Right.
All right, so thank you. So then the other one I wanted to talk, we could capital projects. So we talked about the ones from municipal building reserve, talked about sewer reserve, we talked about the ambulance. There are four items that would be funded from free cash, the F-550, and the tractor, both for the highway department, the $20,500 for the defibrillator replacement slash update, 11 units in many buildings around town, and the Tilton Library photocopier of $2,099. The CIPC has approved all of these. Would anyone like to speak strongly of us not agreeing with the CIPC recommendations?
And that's a total of $174,599, I think?
Right. Mm-hmm. Yes. All right, I'd make a motion then to agree with and further recommend the CIPC recommendations of $174,599 for those four capital projects to be funded from free cash. I'd like to second that?
Second.
Thank you. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All right, unanimous.
Everybody?
Yep.
Which way?
Mm-hmm. We already talked about CPA. Already talked about COG. Already talked about Smith Folk.
Triennial recertification is one way of not. I was trying to get more clarity on the increase from last year and if there is any balance in that account. I did not receive an answer, so I don't.
Check that email that I sent to you.
Sorry.
I don't know if I included it in there or not. I did print it out, I thought.
Yeah, no, you did, but I
yep.
didn't. Right.
The last paragraph in blue, or second to last paragraph in blue. Right now, the triennial recertification fund has about $55,000 in it.
Okay.
The understanding is that the overall contract, which is a three-year contract, is about $63,000 to $65,000, depending on the specifics of the work.
Okay.
We're basically at the end of that three-year contract. There's two ways that the Finance Committee can choose to recommend. One is to simply leave this in here and know that every year we have to fund about $21,000 to meet the needs of that contract. Mm-hmm. The other thing is to simply do it once every 3 years and fund it for $63,000, in which case the appropriation can simply be continued 1 year to the next. It can be carried over or held over. Either way is valid. I've checked with Brenda on that. Either way is legally permissible and valid.
Right.
To me, to say that, okay, you've got $52,000 or $55,000 in an account for something and you want another $21,500 for that same something, oh, and by the way, you're going to have to renew the contract next year anyways. I talked with Brenda. Legally, the money has to be there before they can sign the contract.
Okay.
The appropriation has to be made before they can sign the contract. So if you
which is due in FY17, just
it's,
to be clear.
Well, there's $20,000 that's going to be due in FY17. We'll be renewing for our next year.
I'm sorry. So I'm sorry. It's due. So the contract,
a portion is due every year.
The contract is renegotiated next year, and every year we pay a third of the contracted amount.
Essentially,
out
yeah.
As the work gets
right. But as we sign the contract, we need to have all the money appropriated.
Okay.
So to appropriate a third every year seems,
and I think that makes sense. And actually, one update with the Municipal Modernization Act that the governor's proposed, they'd be increasing that, I don't know if it's the mandate, but the ability to do it every 5 years.
Do what? Research?
Certification. Mm-hmm.
That would be helpful.
And so,
and it's only going to be $15,000 every year for 5 years or something like that.
I think I already felt this way, but that especially makes it, I think, a bit better to do it some every year. Yeah. You know, like having a once every 5 year blip is even harder than once every 3 year blip.
Is he raising the time limit for a duration of contract that doesn't require a town meeting approval?
That I don't know. It was just a bullet point. And there was a presentation at the municipal conference. There was a breakout on the municipal modernization. I sent those slides around. That's all the information.
Yeah, my understanding is also that the whole reassessment process is a three-year process. It takes 3 years to hit every house, hit every property. They only do a third of the job each year. No, is that not true? Okay.
It takes 9 years for them to hit every house.
Oh, okay.
Oh. Years.
The state, when they purchased due to the full fair valuation, the process was so burdening to small towns.
So maybe the governor's accelerated it and doesn't realize it.
Do a full fair valuation every 9 years.
Okay.
A third of it, 12% per year.
Okay.
12% per year.
Okay.
And so in all reality, what happens is the 9 year cycle. Commercially done annually because there is a change.
Sure, that makes sense.
And unfortunately, sitting as an assessor, what you find out is some houses and so forth have not been assessed for 30 years. And the problem being is we have no right to go in. And secondly, contracts are written as a visit, which they have to be. Time is money. So if somebody goes to the house, knocks on the door, nobody answers, that's a visit.
And that's money.
In this day and age, with all the sponsors working, years ago, I believe I did a review of the records and so forth. We're getting about a 10% entry.
Wow.
That's about it. So it's a broken system. And the state is going to get definitely is a broken system.
Okay. Now, the only thing I felt about this one, I think that everybody's kind of on a similar page here, was if we have 55,000 in, could we keep the 17 amount at 20, bringing it up to 75, and then be good for a while? Because I mean, even if 20,000 a year is short by a few thousand, by 1,000 a year, it'd take us almost a lifetime to get back down to not have enough.
Yeah.
So my thought on this one was to recommend a level budget of 20,000. Given that there is money, and not that we're trying to short it. Again, this isn't about use it all today and then next year there's a problem. literally, if it is 60 to 65 grand, even if it's 65 grand every 3 years, with 75 to start, you're going to have 10,000 left over. You'll be at 70 3 years from now, and 65 3 years after that. It'll take you a number of years to get to the point where you don't have more than the full amount when you sign the paperwork, let alone actually have to pay it out. Anyone have any thoughts on that?
Just for me.
Anyone care to recommend that amount?
Yeah, I recommend that approach that we...
Yeah, I second that.
Yeah. All right, all those in favor of $20,000 for assessor's Toronto recertification?
Aye.
All right. Unanimous. All right, guys, it's been very late, and I appreciate all the time and the challenging discussion and votes. We have not handled every single thing, but I feel very good that we've handled the vast majority of what may come up tomorrow. Absent the Frontier budget, I do feel some disappointed not getting that done. But again, I did want to hold off to get a little bit more clarification on something that came up recently.
What's the status on tomorrow?
So tomorrow, Doug, actually, maybe it's the answers on this.
It is not.
I noticed that I had not posted for a meeting for tomorrow night. And it did not, as it's not our standard meeting, it just was not on my radar. I take full responsibility for that. Doug, what sort of limitations or problems does that cause for any of us to be there tomorrow?
Don't talk amongst yourselves.
Okay.
Each of you can attend. You can attend together.
You don't talk to the majority.
Yeah.
Okay.
Four people as a group.
Sure. Right. So
three of us could talk. It's not a meeting.
Okay.
And you get four people or more, now it's a meeting.
Okay. And Doug, how do you see the format tomorrow working with this budget presentation? This is the second year we're not doing it, so we're going to go through each article and then each line item in the budget. And are you or the select board going to present?
I am not quite sure. I'm guessing what will happen is we will go through the warrant articles. We will do a very quick summary of the budget. Mm-hmm. Basically, the Finance Committee report. Mm-hmm. That will be available to individuals as it stands right now, mm-hmm. recommendations as they stand right now. The board will quickly summarize the articles and the intent behind them.
What time does it start?
I believe we said 6:30.
Yeah.
What time?
What?
6:30.
That's what I recall, 6:30.
Here.
Right here.
Right.
What do they plan for time?
I'm hoping no more than a couple of hours. We'll have to see.
For the special? Mm-hmm. And then what for the rest?
This is for public.
It's open. Yeah. It's included as part of the warrant. So it's, yeah, I believe so. Yeah.
Okay. As I've said before, I am very unfortunately not going to be able to be there tomorrow. And I'm sorry for that. I guess it helps us not having four people talking together. But who else will be planning to attend tomorrow?
I know that Skip will likely not be there tomorrow night.
Okay. I will be attending, but as a resident, not.
Okay.
Not a board member.
Okay. All right. Well, anyone who can go, please do go. And I understand that I'm sorry I can't be there to speak, on behalf of the committee as a chairman, but I know you guys are very familiar with the things that we discussed, and I will certainly more than try to make up for that by at town meeting clearly articulating both our position on these individual things and then really try to come up with a narrative of why we connected the things that we did, why we took the approaches we did across these budgets, because even if it doesn't seem like there's a method to the madness so far, that's really what I've spent a lot of time trying to do. And I feel pretty good about being able to articulate why we got to where we did and then be very content with whatever the result of the town meeting vote is. So last thing before we go, next week, I would like to set aside two nights for us to meet. I'm hoping we'll only need one, but I don't want to run out of time. I want to make sure we have a last kind of circle up with the numbers and the general narrative that we're going to discuss. Monday is a holiday, the 18th. So I was thinking Tuesday and Wednesday and wanted to see what may work for you guys of those 2 days. That would be the 19th and 20th, I believe.
The Board of Selectmen meet here on the 20th.
Okay. So we could do Thursday the 21st or do Wednesday in a side room, knowing that that's our second meeting. Which of those 2 days work better for everybody?
I'd say let's do the Wednesday and push through it.
Yeah.
I agree. Wednesday.
Okay. Well, and what I can do, I think, Doug, is just post for Thursday too. And if we get into a situation after Tuesday that there's some real serious lot of time-intensive work to do, mm-hmm. we could maybe push it to Thursday and have the space to ourselves. Is that, I don't want to host a ton of meetings. I don't intend to use all of them, but Doug, what are your thoughts on that?
On the 21st, I'm just quickly checking the calendar to make sure there's no conflict. There's a potential conflict, but not with the space, so.
Okay. Well, no, actually, now that I'm thinking about it, I think I'd rather just post Tuesday and Thursday and plan for those 2 days rather than have a possible conflict.
Once you post them, let me know. Yeah, the Tuesday and Thursday are good in terms of the space. You're fine.
Tuesday and Thursday or Tuesday and Wednesday?
Did you say Tuesday and Thursday?
So 6:30 on both, Tuesday the 19th and Thursday the 21st. Let me just check to make sure that's right.
It's like I said, it's a conflict, but not for anybody on the Finance Committee. So,
will you be able to attend both of those, Doug?
I would be able to attend the Tuesday. I may not be able to attend the Thursday. That's tentative. That's up in the air. I'm not sure yet. So.
Okay. Anybody have anything else they'd like to raise or have us consider before we get into our last week and for tomorrow as well? Anyone have any thoughts on tomorrow, the public presentation?
It's the selectman's show, so we'll just...
And, you know, and I'm sure there's going to be some questions about what we did, and you guys were there, and I know, obviously, some of you may be speaking against the vote of the committee. Either we recommended and you're lower, or we didn't recommend you were higher, you know, whatever. So... I know we'll do great with that. Yes.
That's still not confirmed. There's the assessors have a recommendation. It hasn't gone back to the individual, the company yet, to see if they would agree to it. I'm sorry, the tax agreement? No. It's not yet at the town clerk's office. For the tax agreement?
Yeah.
We'll talk about it afterward.
I'm sorry, which article is this, just so we can kind of all get on?
It's the structured tax finance, or structured tax agreement for Lake Street Development.
Right. Yeah, we have not.
Copy which is on file with the town clerk's office, yeah.
Yeah. Tax agreement.
It's not there yet. It's not there yet. Yep.
Gotcha.
Yep.
Yeah, so there's a number of these that we may be, you know, voting to take no action on, or maybe have information we can pick up in those last couple of meetings. That's unfortunately why we're pushing them to the end, but I think we've got a lot more accomplished. And Doug, when you get a chance before next Tuesday's meeting, if you could recirculate maybe this spreadsheet that has all the requested budgets, all the ones that we voted, and the differences.
Okay. Actually, I'd like to sit with you before I do that to make sure that the numbers that we have agree.
Because we're going to want that, and then we're going to want the summary that feeds, so that when we sit down next Tuesday to start, we can articulate very clearly, here's what we still have to take up, here's where we sit right now. Because, you know what, we may look and say, oh, you know what, we need to go back and revote something because we feel, you know, now free cash is up or down or something else looks different than we thought. And that's why we want this time to make sure that we get everything, you know, tied up. All right. With that, I would accept anybody's motion to adjourn.
Make a motion.
Thank you. Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Thank you, everybody. Thank you.